Hi guys, very good evening. How are you all? Uma ma'am, can you hear me? Am I properly audible and visible, everyone? All right, thank you. I'll just check on ma'am once, then we'll start the session. Are we good to go, ma'am? I cannot hear you. You're muted.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Can you hear me now?
Hanji, ma'am, I can hear you. So okay. Can we start, ma'am?
Yeah, just one thing before we start. I have shifted my position, so you better check that everything is in order.
Everything is in order, ma'am. Perfect.
Great.
All right. So, very good evening to everyone. Thank you all for joining. Thank you so much, ma'am, for joining us. And I'll just introduce this session very shortly, and then we'll start with the session that we have today. This is the first and the opening session of the complete CPC live course that LCI is going to deliver, is starting with. And this one is the first introductory session, and we have the good fortune of having ma'am here to start with. And what we're going to do today is that learn and understand the basics of CPC in under three heads. So first is, what is the life cycle of a civil case, which we will briefly discuss about. Then how to understand CPC, as in orders kya hain, sections kya hain, how to use them efficiently and all that. And the third and last topic, which might also get pushed to the next week in the next class, is the difference between writ and original suit. So this will be the agenda today. This course, CPC course, is going to be one course by seven leading lawyers of Delhi, including Senior Advocate Ravi Sikri sir, Senior Advocate Ratan sir, Senior Advocate Ashish Dholakia sir, Advocate Abhishek Paruthi ji, and Mr. Gaurav Goyal, who is our education and knowledge partner also, and very endorsed Mr. Ayushya Kumar also. So we will start with the course in depth after these few introductory sessions. And I'll just introduce ma'am very shortly. It's a very long read. Ma'am's profile is a very, very long one. I'll just tell very shortly. Ma'am is a practicing lawyer since 34 years now. She's been practicing in civil, in criminal, and I think in almost all the fields: arbitration, FERA, real estate, civil service, and everything. And her core strengths are real estate and drafting, and that we are going to learn from ma'am in the coming classes, if it is in our luck. And ma'am has appeared in almost all the tribunals and have been representing a lot and lot of big organizations and PSUs. So I'll give it up to ma'am now, and then we'll start with the session. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Raghav, and good evening, everybody. It's really nice to be here. I'm so sorry, but I seem to have a little bit of an echo. I hope it's not coming through to you guys. If there's a problem, please let me know.
I think it's clear here, ma'am. The voice is clear.
Yeah? Okay, great. Okay. So I have to tell you that I'm really pleased to be able to introduce the CPC, because as a student, I have to tell you that just to share with you, I am a fifth generation lawyer, and I had my first teacher was my father. And my first learnings, I think, were when I was in my single digits. So most children learn about, Enid Blyton's in my days. I don't know what you people read when you were small. But I was able to understand what the Hindu Marriage Act was to some extent by before I was 10 years old, right? Having said that, I knew a lot of law by the time I went to law college. But having said all of this, I have to tell you that one of my biggest challenges was the CPC, because it was just so damn boring. Okay. And I kind of didn't see the relevance of it, and it really didn't become interesting to me. Even CRPC to some extent was interesting, but CPC was like, ye kya hai? Who's going to do this? So that's why I felt that I was very privileged to be able to take this particular session. Because over the years, I've realized that the CPC is actually quite an interesting and an exciting act. And it's also, every time I go to the CPC for something which I need to use, I just marvel at the fact that all those many, many years ago, somebody sat and thought so much about every single situation that could happen and put it there for us to use when we need to now. And a lot of it is completely relevant. So if you look at the CPC, what you're going to find is that the CPC is divided into two parts. The first part is the act is the sections. And the second part of the act is the rules which are in the form of orders. Okay. Now I'm not going into the nitty-gritties of what each order talks about, because that will be dealt with by other people when you do your in-depth CPC training. But the CPC is a procedural act. And it's an act that you will use consistently every time you have to go to court for a civil matter. And so by implication, it means that even when you go to a tribunal, for example, so anything apart from a criminal matter where the criminal procedure code will apply, the CPC is where you will turn by and large. Okay. So it's very important. It's very cross-cutting. It's there are a lot of substantive acts that the CPC will support, right? So anything that you file, whether it's in your HMA, your Hindu Marriage Act, your Transfer of Property Act, it doesn't matter, but it will all be allied with the CPC. And interestingly, I'll just tell you one fact, and that is that the CPC was so comprehensive that they put in a section 151. Section 151 is something that's like an overarching section, which basically gives a court the power to deal with matters where there is no specific procedure power provided. And this is in direct contrast to CRPC, because the CRPC doesn't provide any such thing. There's no such saving power in the CRPC. It's only there in CPC. So when we come to the CPC, if for some reason we feel that a particular provision has not been taken in, we are confronted with a situation which somehow CPC just fails or the law fails us, we can go to section 151. That is not to say that you will use section 151 indiscriminately, but definitely it is to say that it is there to save you should you need to be saved. Okay. Now, why is this? And if you look at the CPC, you will find that the act is far shorter than the rules. The rules are very comprehensive. Every order will have a minimum of 6, 7, 8 parts, and it will deal with various situations. And the sections are comparatively small. They are straightforward. They're easy. Okay. Now, what is the reason for that? Because even in CPC, you have a sort of what I would call, in my own head, that's what I've called it. I've called it a bifurcation. Okay. So the CPC, the sections themselves, the act itself deals with things like jurisdiction. It deals with, you know, what will happen in a civil suit, where you can file it, how you can file an appeal, what is the grievance redressal mechanism going up right up to the Supreme Court. Then it talks about revisions, it talks about reviews, it talks about references. So it talks about basically the entire grievance redressal mechanism, the different kinds of grievance redressal mechanisms that you have at your disposal. So, jab aap CPC ko padhenge, agar aapko koi jurisdiction dekhni hai, aapko ye dekhna hai ki aap appeal is particular case mein appeal ho sakti hai ki nahi ho sakti hai, is order ki appeal ho sakti hai ki nahi ho sakti hai, is आपको ये डिसाइड करना है कि इसमें आप अब ये हो गया है, आपका केस चल रहा है, कुछ हो गया है, तो आप उसमें अपील फाइल करेंगे, रिव्यू फाइल करेंगे, रिविजन फाइल करेंगे, या उसको रेफरेंस में डालेंगे, क्यों डालेंगे, कब डालेंगे, कैसे डालेंगे, ये सब आपको मेन सीपीसी का जो कोर है, जो सेक्शंस हैं, उसमें मिलेगा. और फिर सीपीसी के रूल्स हैं, जो रूल्स हैं उसमें आपको ऑर्डर्स मिलेंगे. ऑर्डर्स में क्या मिलेगा आपको कि जब आप एक केस को प्रोसिक्यूट कर रहे हैं, तो मतलब सपोजिंग आपने एक सिविल सूट डाला ओरिजिनल साइड में, ठीक है, तो अब आप उसको कैसे डालेंगे, उसका फ्रेमवर्क क्या होगा, उसमें कौन पार्टी बनेगा, उसमें कौन, अगर किसी और ने आपके अगेंस्ट सूट डाला है तो उसमें जो पार्टीज हैं वो ठीक है, वो गलत है, अगर वो ठीक नहीं है तो आप कैसे उनको रेक्टिफाई कर सकते हैं, नॉन जॉइंटर ऑफ पार्टीज, मिस जॉइंटर ऑफ पार्टीज, कोई ऐसी पार्टी है जिसका वहां पे कोई मतलब ही नहीं है तो उसको आप कैसे निकालेंगे उस सूट से, वो कैसे अपने आप को निकालेगा उस सूट से, ये सब जो है ये आपको ऑर्डर में मिलेगा. अगर किसी प्लेंटिफ या डिफेंडेंट की डेथ हो गई है या किसी एपिलेंट रिस्पॉन्डेंट की डेथ हो गई है तो आप उसके लीगल हेयर्स को कैसे लेकर आएंगे, आप उसमें अगर आपको उसमें कोई डिस्कवरी चाहिए तो आप कैसे डिस्कवरी करेंगे, जो कैसे कैसे का आंसर आपको थ्रू आउट जो है वो ऑर्डर्स में मिलेगा कि आपको क्या करना, जो भी करना है आपको कैसे करना है. और जो आपकी मेन सेक्शंस हैं सीपीसी की, उसमें आपको कहाँ करना है, आपकी ज्यूरिसडिक्शन कहाँ बनती है, आप सिविल सूट डालेंगे उसके बाद आप अपील डालेंगे तो वो कहाँ जाएगी, रिव्यू डालेंगे तो वो किस कोर्ट के सामने जाएगी, उसमें ये लिखा हुआ है कि एग्जीक्यूशन आप कैसे करेंगे, मान लीजिए आपकी डिक्री हो गई, ठीक है, और जो जजमेंट डेटर है वो उस डिक्री को ऑनर नहीं कर रहा है, उसको जो करना चाहिए वो नहीं कर रहा है, तो आप क्या करेंगे, आप एग्जीक्यूशन में जाएंगे. जब आप एग्जीक्यूशन में जाएंगे तो आप कहाँ जाएंगे, कौन से कोर्ट में जाएंगे, कैसे जाएंगे, उसमें कैसे आप प्रोसीजर अडॉप्ट करेंगे, तो ये सब जो है ये आपको मेन बॉडी में मिलेगा. तो द इम्पॉर्टेंट थिंग इज कि जो हमें समझ में आया इतने सालों की प्रैक्टिस में, हमें ये समझ में आया कि कोई भी इंसान ये नहीं कह सकता कि एट अ गिवन पॉइंट इन टाइम उसको सब लॉ पता है, और पता होनी भी नहीं चाहिए, बिकॉज देन इट्स जस्ट क्लटरिंग योर ब्रेन फॉर नो गुड रीजन. ठीक है, आपको क्या चाहिए, आपको चाहिए कि आपको ये पता होना चाहिए कि अगर आपको कुछ करना है तो आप उसको कहाँ से ढूंढ सकते हैं, कैसे आप अप्लाई कर सकते हैं, क्या ढूंढना है आपको, किधर ढूंढना है, ये इंपॉर्टेंट होता है. अगर आपको ये पता चल जाए तो इट इज लाइक एन लॉ इज लाइक फॉर लॉयर्स इज लाइक एन ओपन बुक टेस्ट. ठीक है, तो आपको नहीं पता, आप ढूंढिए, आपको मिल जाएगी. बट कई बार क्या होता है कि लॉयर्स फ्रस्ट्रेट इसलिए हो जाते हैं, यंग लॉयर्स पर्टिकुलरली, बिकॉज उनको ये ही नहीं पता होता कि वो ढूंढे कहाँ से, वेयर शुड दे लुक, तो इसलिए आई फील दैट ये जब हम एक्ट्स को पढ़ते हैं तो हमें उसमें से जो रोजमर्रा के सेक्शन हैं वो जो उसमें से जो उसका एक फॉर्मेट होता है का पर्टिकुलरली सीपीसी में वो हमें पता होना चाहिए. तो ये नहीं है कि अगर आपको अब ढूंढना है कि जी हमारे क्लाइंट की डेथ हो गई है और हमें अब उसके लीगल रिप्रेजेंटेटिव्स को ऑन रिकॉर्ड लाना है, तो आपको यही नहीं पता कि आप कौन से एक्ट में जाएंगे, आप कहाँ ढूंढेंगे. और सीपीसी में भी जाएंगे तो इतना वास्ट सीपीसी है, आपको यही नहीं पता कि आप एग्जैक्टली कहाँ ढूंढेंगे. और एक चीज और ध्यान में रखिएगा प्लीज कि सीपीसी में स्टेट अमेंडमेंट्स भी होती हैं. तो कई चीजें जो स्टेट्स के ऊपर छोड़ी गई हैं, स्टेट्स ने अपने रूल्स बनाए हुए हैं, तो वो भी जरूरी है. अगर आप एक्ट को देखेंगे तो आपको पता चलेगा कि सेक्शन तो छोटा सा है, उसके बाद नीचे ढेर सारे फलानी स्टेट, ढमकानी स्टेट, ये वो. तो जो आपको जरूरत है आप उसमें से ढूंढ सकते हैं. ठीक है, ये एक बिल्कुल जो सिंपल क्रक्स ऑफ द मैटर होता है वो आपको सीपीसी में ढूंढने के लिए बस उसके जो इंडेक्स में जाइएगा एंड लुक, जब आप देखेंगे आपको पता चल जाएगा कि उसमें पार्ट्स बने हुए हैं. जो मेन सीपीसी है उसमें पार्ट्स बने हुए हैं. एक पार्ट एग्जीक्यूशन के साथ डील करता है, एक पार्ट अपील्स के साथ डील करता है, एक पार्ट रिव्यूज, रेफरेंसेस, रिविजन्स के साथ डील करता है. तो आपको बहुत आसानी हो जाती है कि आप डायरेक्टली उसमें जाएं और आप देखें कि आपको क्या चाहिए और आप कैसे कर सकते हैं. उसमें ऑर्डर्स मिलेंगे आपको कि कौन से ऑर्डर्स आप अपील कर सकते हैं, कौन से ऑर्डर्स आप अपील नहीं कर सकते हैं. ऐसे भी ऑर्डर्स हैं जो आप अपील नहीं कर सकते हैं. So that is as far as the overview of the CPC goes. ठीक है, इसके साथ साथ हम आपको एक चीज कहना चाहेंगे which is directly related to pleadings. आजकल हमने देखा है कि जो young lawyers हैं वो क्या करते हैं, because internet हमारे जमाने में तो नहीं होता था, तो वो internet पे जाते हैं और उनको कहीं ना कहीं से कोई ना कोई फॉर्मेट मिल जाता है. तो उनको सूट डालना है, वो फॉर्मेट देखेंगे, उस फॉर्मेट के हिसाब से अपना सूट बनाएंगे और उसको डाल देंगे. ठीक है, प्लीज एक बात याद रखिए कि आपका केस कोई फॉर्मेट नहीं है. योर केस हैज टू बी क्राफ्टेड. एवरी केस डिपेंड्स ऑन फैक्ट्स. अपने फैक्ट्स को देखिए, ये समझिए कि आपको क्या प्रूव करना है, क्यों प्रूव करना है और आप कैसे उसको प्रूव कर सकते हैं. दूसरी पार्टी क्या ऑब्जेक्शन लेगी, जब वो ऑब्जेक्शन लेगी तो आप उसको कैसे काउंटर करेंगे, ये सब आपको पहले से सोचकर ओनली देन कैन यू स्टार्ट योर ड्राफ्टिंग. तो हमारे ऑफिस में द फर्स्ट थिंग दैट पीपल लर्न is कि जब आपको कोई नए फैक्ट्स मिलते हैं, कोई क्लाइंट आता है, क्लाइंट अपनी स्टोरी सुनाता है आपको, ठीक है, तो आप ये 100% समझ कर चलिए कि ये जो स्टोरी सुना रहा है ये 100% सच नहीं है. इसके डॉक्यूमेंट्स आप देखिए, जब आप डॉक्यूमेंट्स देखेंगे तो आपको पता चलेगा कि ये जो स्टोरी है ये डॉक्यूमेंट्स के हिसाब से कितनी सच है और कितनी इसमें ट्विस्ट आती है डॉक्यूमेंट्स को लेकर. ठीक है, उसके बाद आपके पास एक थर्ड, अभी भी एक थर्ड काम है करने के लिए, और वो ये है कि आप अपने क्लाइंट को पूछें कि भाई ये तो तुम्हारी स्टोरी है, लेकिन अगर हम ऑपोजिट पार्टी को पूछें तो वो क्या बताएगा, उसकी क्या स्टोरी है. जब वो उसकी स्टोरी बताएगा, अब आपके पास तीन वर्जन हो गए, आपके क्लाइंट की स्टोरी, जो डॉक्यूमेंट्स बता रहे हैं वो स्टोरी, और तीसरा जो ऑपोजिट पार्टी स्टोरी बताएगी. समझ रहे हैं आप? अब आपको डिसाइड करना है कि आपको कौन से फैक्ट्स लेने हैं और कौन से नहीं लेने हैं, बिकॉज every fact is not material. Some facts can hurt you. वो facts आप या तो totally avoid कर देंगे, आप अपनी story ऐसे बनाएंगे ताकि वो fact ही ना आए जो आपको hurt करता है. और अगर आपको ये पता चल जाता है आपके क्लाइंट से बात करके कि ये दूसरी पार्टी तो ऑब्जेक्शन देने ही वाली है और उसके पास कुछ प्रूफ भी है, तो फिर आप देखेंगे कि उस फैक्ट को आप कैसे मोल्ड करके लिखेंगे ताकि व्हेन द ऑब्जेक्शन इज टेकन दैट ऑब्जेक्शन बिकम्स न्यूट्रलाइज्ड और इट बिकम्स लेस हार्मफुल टू यू देन इट वुड बी इन अदर सर्कमस्टांसेस. तो जब आप ओरिजिनल केस बनाते हैं प्लीज फॉर्मेट देखकर मत बनाइएगा. सीपीसी है आपके पास, खोलिएगा, यू विल फाइंड आउट कि फ्रेमवर्क ऑफ सूट्स क्या होना चाहिए, उस फ्रेमवर्क में आपको बनाना है. ये 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 पॉइंट्स कंपलसरी हैं, ये आपको लिखने ही लिखने हैं. उसके आगे पीछे ऊपर नीचे आप जो मर्जी लिखना चाहें आप लिख सकते हैं, प्रोवाइडेड इट इज रेलेवेंट. ठीक है, सो इसलिए प्लीडिंग्स के लिए ये बहुत जरूरी है कि आप पर्टिकुलरली इफ यू आर द प्लेंटिव्स लॉयर, तो आपको पहल करनी है, आपको बताना है कोर्ट को कि क्या प्रॉब्लम है, क्या डिस्प्यूट है और आपके क्लाइंट को क्या हानि हुई है और आपको कोर्ट से क्या रिलीफ चाहिए. तो उस केस में आपको बहुत केयरफुली काम करना है कि आप कोर्ट को ऐसा कुछ नहीं बताएंगे बियॉन्ड अ सर्टन पॉइंट. आई एम नॉट सेइंग 100%, कोई भी चीज लॉ में 100% नहीं होती है. हम अगर बात भी करते हैं, हम क्लाइंट को ये कभी नहीं कहते कि ये केस आप 100% जीत जाओगे. हम कहते हैं अकॉर्डिंग टू अस 99% आपको ये केस जीत जाना चाहिए. Why? Because आई एम नॉट द जज. हमने ऑर्डर को साइन नहीं करना, हमने जजमेंट नहीं लिखनी है, हमने खाली अपना केस प्रेजेंट करना है और उसके बाद हमने जज पे छोड़ देना है कि अगर हमने अपना केस ठीक ठाक प्रेजेंट किया है तो जो हमें रिलीफ चाहिए हमें मिलनी चाहिए. ठीक है ना. तो इसलिए आई एम नॉट सेइंग कि आप बिल्कुल मतलब उस फैक्ट को ओमिट कर दीजिए जो आप प्रूव नहीं कर सकते हैं. अगर उसका आप कुछ बेनिफिट ले सकते हैं तो आप जरूर लीजिएगा, लेकिन ये नहीं हो कि आपकी प्लीडिंग्स 80% हवा में और 20% फैक्ट्स पे चल रही हैं. उसमें फिर आपको बहुत नुकसान भी होता है. वाई? बिकॉज कोर्ट ये समझता है कि आप तो हैबिचुएटेड है कि आप एक चीज को जो कि आप प्रूव नहीं कर सकते हैं, जो सच नहीं है, आप एक कहानी सुना रहे हैं हमको एंड यू आर टेकिंग अस फॉर अ राइड. अगर आप कहते हैं ना कि अगर आटे में नमक मिलाओ तो चलेगा, नमक में आटा मिलाने से नहीं चलेगा, है ना. तो वही स्टोरी है यहाँ पर भी. सो यू हैव टू बी केयरफुल. बट ये जो फॉर्मेट्स होते हैं, क्योंकि फॉर्मेट्स में क्या प्रॉब्लम होती है, फॉर्मेट्स में प्रॉब्लम ये होती है कि आप अपने जो पर्सनल फैक्ट्स हैं उनको भूलकर आप फॉर्मेट की तरफ देखते हैं. अब फॉर्मेट में क्या फैक्ट्स थे, उनने क्या लिखकर सोचा, उन्होंने क्या समझाया आपको, क्यों समझाया, तो उसमें आप you get busy in trying to actually put your facts and fit them into a format, whereas you don't need to do that. You need to craft your own case. अब बात यह है कि crafting a case कैसे craft करते हैं आप? आपकी language जो है वो जितना हद से आप कर सकते हैं इट शुड बी सिंपल, स्ट्रेट फॉरवर्ड. एक फैक्ट को एक पैराग्राफ में रखिए, उससे ज्यादा मतलब अगर आप एक ही पैराग्राफ में 10 फैक्ट्स डाल देंगे तो कोर्ट भी एक पैराग्राफ का शुरू में पढ़ता है, वो सोचता है कि अच्छा ठीक है इसमें तो ये लिखा हुआ है कि ये एक सिचुएशन हुई थी, और वो छोड़ देता है उस पैराग्राफ को बिकॉज ही थिंक्स कि अच्छा ये चार पेज का पैराग्राफ है, इसमें ये एक इंसिडेंट डिस्क्राइब किया है, I've understood the incident, I can move on. Without realizing कि आपने उस एक पैराग्राफ में 6 और incidents भी mention करे हैं. 6 incidents हैं, उनको अलग अलग पैराग्राफ में डालिए. और अगर उसमें भी एक पैराग्राफ में नहीं फिट आता है, normally my rule of thumb is कि एक पैराग्राफ should not be more than one sentence. जो भी आप उस sentence में फिट करते हैं, जो fact आप उस sentence में फिट कर सकते हैं उसको करिए, उसके बाद नेक्स्ट पैराग्राफ में चले जाइए. explain it in the next paragraph. Sometimes one incident may take you 4 paragraphs. But be conscious कि आलतू फालतू बातें नहीं, मेन मुद्दे पे आइए और क्यों आप वो इंसिडेंट एक्चुअली क्या हुआ, आप उस इंसिडेंट को क्यों लिख रहे हैं, ये लिखिए और आगे बढ़ जाइए. ठीक है, तो ये हमारा हो गया थोड़ा सा इंट्रोडक्शन इनटू व्हाट प्लीडिंग्स आर एंड व्हाई प्लीडिंग्स शुड ऑलवेज बी सेल्फ जनरेटेड एंड डोंट लुक फॉर फॉर्मेट्स. फॉर्मेट्स आर गुड ओनली इफ यू कैन लुक एट देम एंड से कि इसमें कॉज ऑफ एक्शन होना चाहिए, इसमें टेरिटोरियल ज्यूरिसडिक्शन का पैराग्राफ होना चाहिए, इसमें पिक्यूनियरी ज्यूरिसडिक्शन का पैराग्राफ होना चाहिए कि ये केस कहाँ लाए करता है, हम किस कोर्ट के सामने इसको दायर करेंगे. इसके लिए डेफिनेटली आप फॉर्मेट जरूर देखिए, लेकिन आपकी मेन बॉडी ऑफ द केस के लिए फॉर्मेट देखने की जरूरत नहीं है और उस पर रिलाई करने की जरूरत नहीं है कि जैसे फॉर्मेट ने बोला है आप अपने फैक्ट्स को वैसे मोल्ड करिए. ठीक है, तो ये तो हो गई जो हमारी मेन प्लीडिंग्स, थोड़ा बहुत आई हैव एक्सप्लेन टू यू एंड नाउ वी कैन मूव टू हाउ डू वी यूज सीपीसी. आपका जो केस है, जो आपका सूट है, वो एक्चुअली सीपीसी में नहीं बट बाय एंड लार्ज वो कहीं और किसी और लॉ में दायर होगा. सो फॉर एग्जाम्पल यू विल हैव, let's say there is a property dispute, landlord tenant dispute, there is a dispute which is related to matrimonial matter, aapka Hindu marriage act hai. theek hai, to us case mein aap main law pe jayenge aur cpc jo hai wo aapko ye samjhayega ki aapko us relief ko lene ke liye अपना सूट कैसे डालना है. सो इट्स अ प्रोसीजरल लॉ, इट इज अ हैंडमेडन टू द सब्सटैंटिव लॉ. आपने स्पेसिफिक रिलीफ एक्ट में एक स्पेसिफिक परफॉर्मेंस मांगनी है किसी पर्टिकुलर कॉन्ट्रैक्ट की, तो आप सीपीसी में उस सूट को ड्राफ्ट करेंगे. आपकी ज्यूरिसडिक्शन कहाँ होगी वो आपको सीपीसी बताएगा, स्पेसिफिक रिलीफ एक्ट नहीं बताएगा. ट्रांसफर ऑफ प्रॉपर्टी एक्ट में आपको ज्यूरिसडिक्शन कहाँ होगी, आपका कौन सा कोर्ट होगा, आपका जो सूट होगा वो क्या होगा, वो आप सीपीसी में ड्राफ्ट करेंगे. ट्रांसफर ऑफ प्रॉपर्टी एक्ट का आप सेक्शन लेंगे और आप उसको कंबाइन करेंगे सीपीसी के साथ और आप उसको फाइल करेंगे. ठीक है, तो सीपीसी जो है वो एक It is the most important conjunctive along with the main act. Relief आपकी main act से आएगी और जो आपका procedural aspect है, pleadings हैं, सब जो यहाँ पर आप court में जाते हैं, आपका जो court में upward mobility है वो CPC regulate करेगा. So now CPC tells us that हम लोग जब केस फाइल करते हैं तो केस फाइल करने के बाद देर आर टू पार्ट्स टू द केस एज फार एज द जुडिशियल प्रोसेस इज कंसर्न. वन इज ऑर्डर्स एंड वन इज द जजमेंट. जजमेंट ऑलवेज कम्स विद अ डिक्री. डिक्री मीन्स जब आपकी डिक्री शीट बनती है तो जजमेंट में जज जो है अपनी रीजनिंग देता है और एक वो देता है कि इसलिए हम किसके फेवर में डिसाइड कर रहे हैं. जो आपकी डिक्री शीट बनती है उसमें डायरेक्शंस होती हैं कि ये जो हमने डिसाइड किया है कि फलाने के फेवर में या धमकाने के फेवर में वो एग्जैक्टली कैसे फॉलो होंगी. तो अगर फॉर एग्जांपल लेट्स से देयर इज अ लैंडलॉर्ड टेनेंट डिस्प्यूट, कोर्ट कहता है कि जी हम लैंडलॉर्ड के फेवर में डिसाइड करते हैं, इट्स एन एविक्शन सूट, टेनेंट को हम एविक्ट करते हैं, तो डिक्री शीट में ये होगा कि वो जो एविक्शन है वो उसको टेनेंट को 6 महीने का टाइम है, वो खुद ही अपने आप को वहाँ प्रॉपर्टी से रिमूव करके लैंडलॉर्ड को चाबी दे सकता है एंड टेक नोट फ्रॉम हिम दैट ही हैज हैंडेड ओवर अ पोजेशन नोट एंड देन उसका काम खत्म हो गया. ठीक है, छह महीने के अंदर अंदर टेनेंट को पता है कि हमको ये वापस करना है प्रॉपर्टी को, पार्टीशन का सूट है, पार्टीशन की डिक्री हो गई, तो पार्टीशन की डिक्री में ये होगा कि ये जो प्रॉपर्टी है ये पार्टीशन हो सकती है या नहीं हो सकती है फिजिकली। कई प्रॉपर्टीज फिजिकली पार्टीशन नहीं हो सकती हैं, तो उसमें क्या होता है कि फिर कोर्ट कहता है कि देर आर डिफरेंट मेथडोलॉजीज ऑफ डिवाइडिंग दैट प्रॉपर्टी। वन मेथडोलॉजी इज कि दोनों या जो जितने भी को ओनर्स हैं वो आपस में बोली लगा के डिसाइड कर लेते हैं, एक को ओनर जिसकी बोली सक्सेसफुल होती है वो बाकी सब को ओनर्स को अपने हिस्से के बराबर पैसे देकर उसको खत्म कर लेते हैं, इट्स कॉल्ड ओवल्टी मनी। तो कोर्ट कैन डायरेक्ट कि एक पर्टिकुलर ओनर है, आप अपना विद इन 3 months ही विल ऑर्गेनाइज द फंड्स, वो अपना ओवल्टी मनी दे के प्रॉपर्टी जो है उसके नाम पे हो जाएगी, तो उसकी डिक्री शीट बनेगी। पार्टीशन की डिक्री शीट जो होती है वो एक्चुअली आपको रजिस्टर करानी पड़ती है, तो उसमें स्टैम्प ड्यूटी भी लगती है और वो स्टैम्प पेपर आपको कोर्ट को सप्लाई करना पड़ता है, एंड देन उसमें डिक्री शीट बनती है और वो डिक्री शीट जो है आपको जाकर सब रजिस्ट्रार के पास, जैसे आप सेल डीड्स रजिस्टर करते हैं या पावर्स ऑफ अटॉर्नी रजिस्टर करते हैं, ऐसे ही आपको पार्टीशन डिक्री भी रजिस्टर करनी पड़ती है, ठीक है। तो अब ये हो गया हमारा जो जजमेंट एंड डिक्री का पार्ट है, ठीक है। अब आ गए हम ऑर्डर्स पे। कोर्ट ड्यूरिंग द प्रोसेस ऑफ द केस बहुत सारे ऑर्डर्स पास करता है, उन ऑर्डर्स में से अगर आप डिससैटिस्फाइड हैं, फॉर एग्जांपल मान लीजिए आपने ऑर्डर 39 रूल 1 एंड 2 की एप्लीकेशन लगाई कि ड्यूरिंग द पेंडेंसी ऑफ दिस पर्टिकुलर केस मुझे स्टे मिलना चाहिए, कोर्ट ने उसको डिक्लाइन कर दिया, कोर्ट ने कहा हम स्टे नहीं करेंगे, यू आर डिससैटिस्फाइड, आपको लगता है आपको स्टे मिलनी चाहिए थी, तो आपके पास ऑप्शन है कि आप उस ऑर्डर को अपील कर सकते हैं, इट्स कॉल्ड फर्स्ट अपील अगेंस्ट ऑर्डर FAO, ठीक है। तो आप उस ऑर्डर को अपील कर सकते हैं कि मुझे स्टे मिलनी चाहिए थी, मुझे नहीं मिली, एंड देयरफॉर नाउ आई हैव कम इन अपील एंड आई वांट दिस हायर कोर्ट टू सिट इन जजमेंट ओवर द लोअर कोर्ट टू give me the answer as to whether or not I can get my stay, and this FAO then you can go in a second appeal, okay। Now the thing is ki kai baar aapka jo appellate rasta hota hai wo ek had tak hi jata hai, uske baad aapka rasta blocked hai, aap usse aage appeal nahi kar sakte hain। ये जो है ये आपको सीपीसी से पता चलेगा कि आप किस ऑर्डर में कितनी अपील कर सकते हैं और कितनी नहीं कर सकते हैं, ठीक है। सिमिलरली जजमेंट एंड डिक्री से आप अपील फाइल कर सकते हैं, इट इज कॉल्ड रेगुलर फर्स्ट अपील RFA, देन रेगुलर सेकंड अपील RSA। जब आपका RFA फाइल होता है तो एक बात ध्यान में रखिए कि RFA जो है इज अ मैटर ऑफ राइट। अगर आप टाइम से RFA फाइल कर देते हैं तो कोर्ट को सुनना ही सुनना है, और उसमें आप पूरे अपने जितने आर्ग्यूमेंट्स हैं ऑन फैक्ट्स ऑन लॉ, आप एक एक पन्ना पढ़ के कोर्ट को समझा सकते हैं कि भाई ये है और क्यों हमको रिलीफ नहीं मिली, बिकॉज अकॉर्डिंग टू मी दैट वॉज नॉट राइट, वाई यू फील दैट, यू कैन एक्सप्लेन इट टू द कोर्ट एट दैट पॉइंट इन टाइम। सो RFA इज अ मैटर ऑफ राइट एंड वो कोई कोर्ट आपको डिनाई नहीं कर सकती। देन यू कम टू अ रेगुलर सेकेंड अपील। अगर RFA में भी आपको नहीं मिलता है सेटिस्फैक्शन, आप सेकेंड अपील में जा सकते हैं, उसमें यू हैव टू बी मोर केयरफुल बिकॉज नाउ यू हैव टू एक्सप्लेन टू द कोर्ट लीगली स्पीकिंग व्हाट इज द क्वेश्चन ऑफ लॉ दैट वाज इन्वॉल्व्ड। जब आप सुप्रीम कोर्ट जाते हैं, आप एक SLP फाइल करते हैं, तो उसमें आपको सुप्रीम कोर्ट को सबसे पहले, उसमें तो द फॉर्मेट इज सच कि आपको बताना पड़ता है कि आप कोर्ट की कंसिडरेशन के लिए कौन सा फैक्ट ऑफ लॉ लेकर आ रहे हैं, कौन सा लीगल पॉइंट लेकर आ रहे हैं where you feel the law has been misapplied, why do you feel the law has been misapplied, what is the question of law that the Supreme Court should actually take cognizance of and debate. Or ye, when you come to Supreme Court, it is very important to remember ki ye jo aapke questions of law aap banate hain, these are, see, Supreme Court has a 95% rate of dismissal. जो आपका क्वेश्चन ऑफ लॉ है अगर वो आपने ढंग से बना लिया एंड इट कैचेस द आई ऑफ द सुप्रीम कोर्ट, तो आपकी अपील एडमिट हो जाएगी, आपकी एसएलपी जो स्पेशल लीव पिटीशन है वो एडमिट हो जाएगी एंड देन द सुप्रीम कोर्ट विल हियर इट. बट यू हैव टू बी वेरी वेरी केयरफुल ऑन दिस पॉइंट दैट योर क्वेश्चन ऑफ लॉ शुड बी वेरी क्लियर, कंसाइज, एंड इट शुड बी understandable as a question which ought to be decided by the Supreme Court. It's a little difficult proposition, but that's how it is. Okay. I think, Raghav, at this point, if anybody has any questions, maybe it's a good idea, because nahi to, you know, we'll be all over the place and in loco.
Right, ma'am. So anyone, if you have any question, you can send us the question in the Q&A chat and we'll take it up. And in the meantime, ma'am, if there's anything that we can go forward with, we can. And jaisi questions aate hain, we'll take them.
Okay. So I just want to actually go a little more into pleadings. What are pleadings? Pleadings are basically your submissions to the court. आप court को क्या बता रहे हैं? और उन pleadings में से निकल कर आता है कि इन facts के ऊपर मुझे ये relief चाहिए. ठीक है? तो वो जो facts होते हैं वो आप अपने evidence act में जाएंगे. Again a procedural act. तो उसमें defined है कि आपके facts and issue क्या है, मतलब dispute क्या है, issue क्या है, जिसमें आपके कंफ्लिक्टिंग दो लोगों के अलग अलग स्टांसेस हैं और वो कोर्ट को रिजॉल्व करनी है, दैट इज द डिस्प्यूट. तो आपको असेंशली उस डिस्प्यूट से रिलेटेड जितने भी फैक्ट्स हैं, दे आर फैक्ट्स एंड इशू एंड रेलेवेंट फैक्ट्स, वो आपको प्लीडिंग्स में डिफाइन करने हैं और लिखना है. तो ये तो हमने आपको पहले बता दिया कि प्लीडिंग्स जो है देर शुड बी कंसाइज, ज्यादा उसमें रेपिटेशन नहीं होना चाहिए. लेकिन दैट डज नॉट मीन कि आप प्लीडिंग्स को कंसाइज करने के चक्कर में उसको इतना कंसाइज कर दें कि उसकी क्लैरिटी चली जाए. प्लीडिंग्स मस्ट बी वेरी क्लियर. जो इंसान पढ़े उसको कुछ पता हो या ना पता हो, आपकी प्लीडिंग पढ़ के उसको समझ में आ जाए कि एग्जैक्टली केस किस टॉपिक से रिलेटेड है, क्यों केस किया गया है, क्या रिलीफ चाहिए और क्यों रिलीफ चाहिए. तो pleadings must be very clear and they normally we say that pleadings should follow a certain course. First paragraph jo aapka pleadings ka hota hai, hamesha usme aap apni relief batayenge ki court ko pata chal jaye chhootte sari ki humko kya relief chahiye. Uske baad jab aap next paragraph mein aayenge to aap ye batayenge ki aapka us relief se kya lena dena hai, aap kyun lekar aaye hain usko, kyun aap maang rahe hain. और उसके बाद आप अपने फैक्ट्स लिखेंगे और नॉर्मली फैक्ट्स को क्रोनोलॉजिकल ऑर्डर में लिखिए, पहला फैक्ट पहले, उसके बाद जो भी आपकी स्टोरी है वो एक एक करके बढ़नी चाहिए और फिर फाइनली उसके बाद आप जो है उसमें पैराग्राफ्स डालेंगे जो टेरिटोरियल ज्यूरिसडिक्शन के हैं, जो पेक्यूनियरी ज्यूरिसडिक्शन के हैं, कि आपका कौन से कोर्ट में क्यों ये केस दायर होना चाहिए. And finally, very important, cause of action. Why? Because every case has a limitation. ऐसा नहीं है कि आपका dispute आज खड़ा हुआ और suddenly आप 25 साल के बाद जागे और आपने बोला कि अरे मेरा dispute था एक, वो तो मैं भूल गई थी, चलो मैं आज कर लेती हूँ. ऐसा नहीं हो सकता. तो हर केस का एक limitation होता है. वो limitation जो होता है वो आपके cause of action से निकल कर आता है कि आपका केस विद इन टाइम है कि नहीं है, और ऑल्सो कोर्ट को आपके कॉज ऑफ एक्शन पैराग्राफ से पता चलता है कि आपका क्या रीजन है कि आप कोर्ट आए हैं, आपको क्यों ये करना पड़ा. तो कॉज ऑफ एक्शन जो है वो मल्टीपल्स में भी हो सकता है. ऐसा नहीं है कि एक ही कॉज ऑफ एक्शन पे आप कोर्ट आती हैं, आप मल्टीपल कॉजेज ऑफ एक्शन पे भी कोर्ट आ सकते हैं. तो आप ये कह सकते हैं कि फॉर एग्जाम्पल कि ये जो टेनेंट है, आई एम द लैंडलॉर्ड, मैंने इसको लीज दिया था, एक साल का लीज था, इसने एक साल के बाद खाली नहीं किया, तो कॉज ऑफ एक्शन पैराग्राफ में आप लिखेंगे दैट द कॉज ऑफ एक्शन फर्स्ट अरोज व्हेन द टेनेंट डिड नॉट himself vacate the premises at the end of the lease period. Then humne usko notice diya. So the cause of action again arose when I gave a notice. The cause of action arose when the 15 days I gave him to vacate the premises elapsed and he did not vacate the premises. Then I have come to court. This is your cause of action paragraph. ऐसे आप एक एक करके अपना कॉज ऑफ एक्शन उसमें पूरा लिखेंगे एंड यू हैव टू मेक इट क्लियर जो आपका लास्ट कॉज ऑफ एक्शन का डेट होगा वहां से आपकी लिमिटेशन गिनी जाएगी. ठीक है.
कैन आई इंटरजेक्ट विद द क्वेश्चंस हियर मैम बिकॉज़ वी हैव रिसीव्ड अ फ्यू.
या
सो फर्स्ट क्वेश्चन इज फ्रॉम मिस सोनल मोदी. शी वांट्स टू आस्क मैम व्हाट इज द नेक्स्ट स्टेप ऑफ एक्शन इन अ सिविल सूट दैट इज what are the steps right from the filing onwards, if you can give a brief of that.
Yeah, sure. So aap apna suit file karte hain, aapka suit take up ho jata hai. Please remember that a suit is a matter of right. So agar aap suit file karte hain, usko keval registry procedurally examine karegi ki aapka sab ठीक फॉर्मेट ठीक है, आपने एफिडेविट्स लगाए हैं नहीं लगाए हैं, वकालतनामा है नहीं है, ऑल दैट, और आपका सूट रजिस्टर हो जाएगा. फिर वो सूट कोर्ट में पहुंचेगा. तो सबसे पहले जो कोर्ट है, कोर्ट उसमें 99.9% अनलेस देयर इज अ ग्लेयरिंग डेफिशिएंसी इन द सूट, कोर्ट उसमें नोटिस कर देगा ऑपोजिट पार्टी को कि भाई आइए और ये आपके अगेंस्ट एक्शन आया, बताइए क्या होना है. तो जब नोटिस जाएगा ऑपोजिट पार्टी आएगी. अब जब ऑपोजिट पार्टी आती है तो ऑपोजिट पार्टी के पास दो ऑप्शन. पहला ऑप्शन ये है कि वो 7-10 या 7-11, ऑर्डर 7-10 या ऑर्डर 7-11 में एक ऑब्जेक्शन दायर करे कि ऑर्डर 7-10 में ज्यूरिसडिक्शन के अगेंस्ट ऑब्जेक्शन होता है कि ये सूट इस ज्यूरिसडिक्शन में लाए नहीं करता है, वॉट एवर योर रीजन आर, आप कर सकते हैं. दूसरा 7-11 दैट द प्लेंट डज नॉट डिस्क्लोज एनी कॉज ऑफ एक्शन. तो अगर आपकी प्लेंट ही डेफिशिएंट है, उसमें कॉज ऑफ एक्शन ही नहीं है, तो आप 7-11 फाइल करके उस सूट को डिसमिस करा सकते हैं. नाउ आई विल गिव यू अ वेरी वेरी रिडिकुलस एग्जांपल, बट एक्चुअली वन ऑफ द केसेस some junior lawyer filed, I felt very sorry for him, but galti to usse ho gayi thi. He filed, usne cause of action ka para hi nahi dala. So I filed a 7-11 and the court told him, I'm so sorry, but I have to dismiss your suit. I have no option but to dismiss because aapne to cause of action hi nahi likha hai. So the after this, अगर आपको उस नोटिस मिला एज एन अपोजिंग काउंसिल, यू आर द डिफेंडेंट्स लॉयर, नाउ यू हैव गॉट अ सूट, यू विल फाइल ए रिटन स्टेटमेंट एंड यू विल फाइल ए रेप्लिकेशन टू एनी एप्लीकेशंस व्हिच हैव बीन फाइल्ड विद द सूट. फॉर एग्जांपल देयर मे बी एन ऑर्डर 39 रूल 1 एंड 2, दैट्स द नॉर्मल कि हमें फला चीज स्टे करी जाए या ढमकानी चीज स्टे करी जाए या स्टेटस को मेंटेन करा जाए, जो भी है. तो आप उन दोनों चीजों का जवाब देंगे. योर रिप्लाई इज कॉल्ड अ रिटन स्टेटमेंट एंड योर आंसर टू एन एप्लीकेशन इज कॉल्ड अ रेप्लिकेशन. ठीक है. जब आपने ये दोनों चीजें कर ली, आपने फाइल कर दिया, देन द प्लेंटिफ हैज द राइट कि वो आपकी रिटन स्टेटमेंट का जवाब दे. नाउ द रीजन बिहाइंड दैट इज दैट प्लेंटिफ अपनी बात जब कहता है, he is supposed to put his full facts before the court. when the defendant replies, he also puts his full facts, but he has a chance to rebut the facts given by the plaintiff. But he may put some new facts also. So, isliye plaintiff ko ek chance diya jata hai in a rejoinder to rebut whatever the defendant says, and then the pleadings come to an end. But again, law mein kuch 100% nahi hota hai. I told you this before. So, kuch cases mein, bahut rare cases mein, you can, as a defendant's lawyer, ask for the right to give a surrejoinder. Surrejoinder is S-U-R, rejoinder. A surrejoinder is a rejoinder which you give by pointing out to the court ki rejoinder mein isne nae facts leke aaye hain, jo inhone plaint mein nahi liye. Aur un facts ko rebut karne ke liye, I have to file a further rejoinder. So you can ask for a permission to file a surrejoinder. Okay, but this is where the pleading ends. Once your pleading is at an end, then the next stage is that your evidence will start. These days, all evidence in a lot of criminal matters and all civil matters happens by way of affidavit of evidence. Aajkal law examination in chief nahi hota hai, only cross examination hota hai, which is physically held in court. So, aapko affidavit by way of evidence banana padega. Aap affidavit by way of evidence banayenge, uske baad aap usko file karenge, aap apni list of witnesses denge. List of witnesses jab aap denge, to ye aapko actually jo bhi us stage ka sort of expanded class lega, to wo aapko samjhayega ki list of witnesses mein bhi witnesses kai tarah ke hote hain. एंड उनको कैसे बुलाया जाता है, कौन से विटनेसेस हैं जो खुद बुलाते हैं, वो कौन से विटनेसेस हैं जो कोर्ट समन करता है, व्हाट इज द प्रोसीजर, दे विल एक्सप्लेन इट टू यू. बट एसेंशियली यू विल फाइल अ लिस्ट ऑफ विटनेसेस एंड यू विल फाइल द एफिडेविट. नाउ बिटवीन द स्टेज ऑफ एग्जामिनेशन एंड द स्टेज ऑफ कंप्लीशन ऑफ प्लीडिंग्स, देयर इज वन स्टेज व्हिच इज that the court will decide on what issues this case will be proceeded. So, usme kya hota hai? You have to be very careful at that stage, because when the framing of issues happens, agar aapki relevant issues mein frame nahi hoti hai, to that issue will have no bearing on the final outcome of the case. Aap usko prove bhi kar lenge through your examination and cross-examination, court उसका कोई notice नहीं लेगा, because वो issues में नहीं है. तो जब decree बनती है, जो judgment होती है, उसमें court one by one in an original suit issues decide करता है कि issue number one ये है, issue number two ये है, इसमें हमारा ये कहना है, issue number three में ये है, इसमें हमारा ये कहना है. And what happens is that sometimes the issues are decided not wholly in favor of one party. They could be decided, one issue may be decided for one party, one issue may be decided for another party. But overall court says ki because this party deserves relief or this party, the plaintiff doesn't deserve relief, that is why I'm giving a judgment in favor of the plaintiff or against the plaintiff. ठीक है? तो अब इसके बाद जब आपकी issues frame हो जाती हैं, आप अपना evidence देते हो, your affidavit by way of evidence is filed. उसके बाद आप एक एक विटनेस का क्रॉस एग्जामिनेशन होता है ऑपोजिट पार्टी की तरफ से. एक बार क्रॉस एग्जामिनेशन खत्म हो जाता है, उसके बाद जो प्लेंटिव का एविडेंस है वो क्लोज हो जाता है. ठीक है, अगर आप अपने विटनेसेस को टाइम से नहीं लेके आएंगे, आपको कोर्ट ने अपॉर्चुनिटी दी किसी वजह से, वट एवर रीजन में भी आप विटनेसेस को नहीं लाते हो, आपका जो एविडेंस है वो आपके पूरे विटनेसेस के आने से पहले भी क्लोज हो सकता है. वंस प्लेंटिफ्स एविडेंस इज क्लोज्ड, फिर डिफेंडेंट का एविडेंस शुरू होता है. उसमें डिफेंडेंट भी अपना लिस्ट ऑफ विटनेसेस देता है और अपने एफिडेविट्स देता है बाय वे ऑफ एविडेंस, और उन एफिडेविट्स के बेसिस के ऊपर आप अपने जो ऑपोजिट पार्टी है उसके विटनेसेस को क्रॉस एग्जामिन करते हैं. Once this is done, then there is the stage of final arguments. Final arguments mein jitna pura case mein jo kuch hua hai, jo evidence present hua hai, aapko ye dekhna hai ki kya cheez prove hui hai, kya cheez nahi prove hui hai, aur accordingly aapko court ko batana hai ki dekhiye ye yahan par humne prove kar liya, ye yahan par fala witness ne ye bola tha, ye document prove ho gaya hai. To ye jo hai fir totally एंड में आके आप जब फाइनल आर्ग्यूमेंट्स करेंगे उसके बाद आप कौन सी जजमेंट्स पे रिलाई कर रहे हैं उसके बाद कोर्ट विल देन रिजर्व ऑर्डर्स और दे विल पास ऑर्डर्स इमीडिएटली दे विल पास ऑर्डर्स इन द केस व्हिच विल बी द फाइनल ऑर्डर्स व्हिच इज द जजमेंट एंड डिक्री सो डज दैट आंसर योर क्वेश्चन और यू वांट टू आस्क समथिंग मोर
वेरी क्लियरली मैम वेरी गिव्स अ लॉट ऑफ क्लैरिटी सो देयर इज अ फॉलो अप क्वेश्चन मैम does it mean that आपने cause of action के बारे में बताया था that cause of action की वजह से गलती हो सकती है so does it mean that cause of action paragraph has to be a separate and express one or that or we can have one para that signifies the cause of action is that sufficient
yes there is one actually cause of action का एक single para होता है how you write it is that the cause of action first arose on so and so date when let's take the example I gave when the lease between the plaintiff and the defendant came to an end by efflux of time on so and so date and the defendant did not vacate the said premises colon aap semicolon lagayenge the cause of action further arose when the plaintiff served a notice upon the defendant on so and so date again semicolon lagayenge The cause of action finally arose when the defendant did not vacate the said premises within the 15-day period as directed by the notice dated so and so. ठीक है? ये आपका cause of action.
Right. And ma'am, another question. आपने sir rejoinder के बारे में बताया. Is that a rule or an exception according to CPC?
No, it's a complete exception. In my 37 years of practice. I have filed only 5 sir rejoinders.
All right.
And I've had to fight for 3 of those 5 sir rejoinders. 2, the court was gracious enough to say, yes, I understand. Please take your, file the sir rejoinder. But in 3 of those, I had to fight for it.
All right. Ma'am, another question. Is there a provision of appeal against the first appeal FAO?
The first appeal against order, by and large, no. By and large, no. When you come into the depth of CPC, whoever is teaching you will go through that particular section. So there is a specific section in CPC which categorically says, A, what orders can be appealed against. Then there is another section which says how far you can take that appeal. Where is it? Where is the appeal against an order? Then finally come to arrest. So I'm not going into that for the reason that it doesn't make sense to give you bits and pieces and anticipate what your teachers further are going to tell you because usme aapke khichdi ban jayegi.
Ji ma'am. Next one is ma'am by Saket Jain. He wants to ask tribunals like DRT, do they need to follow CPC and Evidence Act?
They do. अल्टीमेटली घूम फिर के जो हमारी प्लीडिंग्स होती हैं जो भी होती हैं वो सब वहीं पे आके अटकती हैं
ठीक है मैम सो नेक्स्ट
क्वेश्चन बोलेंगे कि इस ट्रिब्यूनल में सीपीसी नहीं लगता उस ट्रिब्यूनल में सीपीसी नहीं लगता पर घूम फिर के इवन इफ यू आर नॉट कोटिंग द सीपीसी जो प्रोसीजरल एस्पेक्ट है वो यू विल टेक इट फ्रॉम सीपीसी
सीपीसी लगेगा
इवन इफ अ ट्रिब्यूनल सेज स्पेसिफिकली कि हमें सीपीसी नहीं लगता है इवन देन जो आपको रिलीफ चाहिए जो आपको वो करना है वो आप डायरेक्टली उसी में लेंगे
राइट सो नेक्स्ट अप इज फ्रॉम मेहर निगर शी वांट्स टू आस्क इफ अ सूट इज नॉट फाइल्ड एज पर द लिमिटेशन एक्ट एंड द पार्टी हैज अ जेन्युइन कॉज फॉर दैट इज देयर एनी पॉसिबिलिटी दैट द कोर्ट विल एक्सेप्ट द प्ली दैट्स कॉन्डोनेशन आई थिंक
यस ओरिजिनल सूट्स की कॉन्डोनेशन नहीं होती है बिकॉज ओरिजिनल सूट फाइल करने के लिए आपके पास बहुत टाइम होता है 3 साल का टाइम होता है नाउ प्लीज रिमेम्बर वन थिंग दैट डजंट मीन दैट इट इज 3 इयर्स नेसेसरीली फ्रॉम द टाइम व्हेन something went wrong. It can be 3 years from the time when you got to know of that fact. So, for example, supposing I have a house and I leave a caretaker in charge of that house, okay, and I go away. Now, I come back after 3 years and I find that us ghar mein koi teesra hi banda reh raha hai, jisko humne permission nahi diya hai, and there's no sight and sound of my caretaker, right? So, I have been sending money to the caretaker. The caretaker has been cashing my checks. They have been making use of the money, whatever it is. I can approach the court and say that I made these arrangements. I have been making these payments. I had no knowledge that my caretaker had absconded and some third party, completely unrelated, is in possession of my house. And therefore, your time will start from the date of knowledge, not from the date when the person actually got into the house.
Right. Perfect, ma'am. So, can we move to the next question?
Sure.
Achha, also, beforehand, ma'am, we have around 40 questions already. So, aap, jab aapko aisa lage ki we have to stop, we'll stop.
Okay. Nahin, I think just let's take the questions because right now we are only at 7 o'clock. We have a full hour. And we don't have a problem.
ठीक है मैम, then whatever will be left हम push कर देंगे उसे next week के लिए. Right.
नहीं, I think the only thing we have left now is the difference between a writ and a civil suit. We can take that in the next session also.
हाँ जी मैम, ठीक है. So मैम, जो आपने cause of action में जिन्होंने गलती करी थी, जिन advocate ने, उसी पे follow up question है, couldn't he have amended the suit to put the cause of action?
He could have. If he had realized the mistake initially, agar court ne dekh liya hota, point out kar diya hota before notice, before my 7-11 came. Once my 7-11 had come, once I had made an objection that he has no cause of action and his plane did not show a cause of action, it was too late.
Aur ma'am, aisi agar galti ho jaye, to uske baad remedy kya hai? What is the best course of action that he could have followed?
Run away and don't face your client. Don't come in contact with your client. Wo aapko marne ke liye aayega. So, aisi galti karna mat.
All right. So, ma'am, next question is, aapne jaise plaint ke baare mein bataya ki there is no one fixed format. And there's always, you know, it is always subject to the circumstances and the situation of your case. So, what should be, this comes from Ms. Kiran. She asked, what should be one general flow of a plaint if we want to know it briefly?
General flow of a plaint, I already explained and I'll do it again because it may not have been very clear, is that in the very first paragraph, tell the judge what you are asking. So what is the relief you're seeking? Okay. In the second paragraph, introduce yourself to the judge and say why you are asking for this particular relief. So let's say, for example, if I am filing a case of a partition suit, now what I'll say is that I am, the plaintiff is filing the present suit for partition of property bearing number so-and-so, situated at so-and-so, of which he is a co-owner, right? Now, this is the first paragraph. Second paragraph, you will say that the said property belonged to my father who left behind a will, and I am one of the inheritors of so much percentage by virtue of that will, right? That's your second paragraph. And then you will go on to say whatever you need to say with respect to the whole this thing.
Right, ma'am.
Right? Once you have finished that, then you come to your procedural paragraphs. Like I told you, you will write about the pecuniary jurisdiction. For example, in Delhi, if the jurisdiction, the pecuniary jurisdiction is a certain amount, then the suit has to go to the High Court, right? Otherwise, it has to be filed in the District Court. So, aapko likhna padega ki agar aap High Court aaye ho, to aap kyun aaye ho? Agar aap District Court ja rahe ho, to aap agar additional district judge ke paas ja rahe ho to aap kyun ja rahe ho? Agar aap civil sub judge ke paas ja rahe ho to aap kyun ja rahe ho? Kitni aapki value hai suit ki, wo aapko likhna padega. Theek hai? Some suits go to particular judges or particular brackets of judges because they are supposed to go there, it doesn't matter whether the value is 2 rupees or 25 rupees. In that case, you will write that the value of the suit for purposes of court fee and jurisdiction is whatever it is. Because aapki jo value of suit ki hai, wo court fee and usme court fee bhi lagti hai. Then next paragraph mein you will write the territorial jurisdiction is this particular court. This particular territory. So for example, if I am located, let's say, in a particular district in Delhi, then I will file the suit in the court where that which is in charge of that district. I cannot file it even in Delhi in a different district. Okay, now then your third paragraph, I explained to you cause of action. Now I'll also explain to you that condonation of delay original suits mein nahi hoti hai, but usme ek exception hai. Exception ye hai that if you pursue a wrong remedy, so it means that you are proactive, but galti karke aapne, for example, you ought to have filed the suit in Delhi, aapne jaake Bombay mein file kar diya. You thought meri jurisdiction Bombay mein banti hai, aapne file kar diya, wo suit reject ho gaya, wo judge ne let's say 1.5 saal laga diya, usme aapki limitation chali gayi, wo suit aap la sakte ho to Delhi and you can say that I filed the suit in Bombay, that was an erroneous jurisdiction and I am now filing it for this delay of 1.5 years or whatever it is, 1 year, 8 months needs to be condoned.
Right.
Okay. Ma'am. Yeah. Also, there is one other exception to the filing of original suits. That other exception is that if any plaintiff is for some reason temporarily mentally infirm, then that period will not count. So you understand this?
Right, ma'am.
So supposing, for example, I am a plaintiff and something happens in my life and I go into a huge depression, and because of that depression, I do not file my suit in time. But I have papers which are showing that that I was in depression, that I was taking medication, that I was very severely depressed. Then I can ask for condonation of delay on that basis.
Right. And if I may add, ma'am, I think this is 6, 7, 8 of Limitation Act, jahan pe limitation stops when there's an infirmity. And once the infirmity is cured, uske baad wo phir se stop nahi hoti kabhi bhi. The limitation keeps running.
Then it goes on running.
Right. Ma'am, jaise aapne cycle of a decree bataya tha hume, usi pe I received 2 similar questions. If we have to take it right now, can you share the flow of a mutual divorce and an injunction case, if that can be done briefly?
Sorry, you have to come again. What?
Ma'am, jaise aapne cycle of a decree bataya tha, usi tarah se I have received 2 questions, similar questions on if you can share the flow of a mutual divorce case and an injunction case very briefly, if that's possible.
Yeah, sure. Okay. So what happens is that a mutual consent basically is limited to 2 motions. First motion, second motion. Second motion is your decree, because there is no fight here. It's by mutual, 2 people have mutually agreed. They come to court, they say that, you know, we want to divorce and this is our first motion. The court will ask both parties that have you signed this out of your free will? Have you thought about it? Everything. How long have you been living apart? All of that. And then they will sign the statements. And that's the end of your first motion. Now, in your first motion, there may be certain things which need to be done by each party. So, for example, if you have decided that the house will go to the wife, the husband will vacate the house, or the husband has to pay some money to the wife will vacate the house, there is some settlement, lump sum maintenance, something like that, whatever it is. And there is a date by which all this needs to be done. Then all of this will be done. Alternatively, if the money has to be paid, let's say on the second motion, then on the second motion, you will come to court and you will, 1 second, please. Somebody switched off the AC, I'm dying. Please put it on. Hello, Yeah, sorry. So the thing is that the second motion will then happen, and you have to show to the court, both parties have to show to the court that they have fulfilled their part of the bargain, which was said in the first motion, and that they still are of the same mind, they still want the same divorce, and then the court will pass a decree. There is no evidence, there is nothing at all. It is just simply two motions. First motion and second motion. First motion will say that these are the parties, this is where they got married, this is, they are both Hindus, they are Muslims, they are whatever, they got married under the Special Marriage Act, they have lived apart for the requisite period, they cannot live together, they mutually want to separate, these are the terms of separation, and that's your first motion, and the court will say the first motion is granted, and within 1 year, you have to come for the second motion, otherwise the first motion will lapse. So you come within the first 1 year. Sometimes people come after 6 months. Sometimes the court doesn't give you a dispensation. Sometimes you can ask the court that we've been living away from each other for 6 years. So we don't want to wait for the 6 month cooling off period. There's been enough cooling off. We are never getting back together. The court can grant, they can waive the cooling off period. They can grant you your second motion, 2 days, 3 days, 5 days, 1 week, 10 days, whatever it may be. Once the second motion comes, second motion, you again have to file. You have to say that I already filed the first motion. So and so date was the order on the first motion. Now I want to finally get divorced. The court will pass a divorce decree.
Right, ma'am. The next one was
in the case of an injunction. The scenario is very different, because in an injunction, when you file a permanent and mandatory injunction, what you're basically telling the court is that some person, XYZ, against whom you have a grievance, needs to be either restrained or from doing something or told to do something. So an injunction is actually an order. An order can be to do or to refrain from doing. Both of them come into the purview of an injunction. Okay, so therefore you can file, when you file the suit, it will run like a regular suit. You will file the injunction, there will be a plaint, there will be a written statement, there will be a rejoinder, then there will be the framing of issues, there will be evidence, and there will be finally a judgment. These are the two distinctions.
Right, ma'am. Ma'am, moving
and
on.
Also, please remember that unless a decree of mutual consent has been obtained by fraud, there is no appeal to a decree of mutual consent. If you wake up 3 days after the decree is passed and realize that you made a big mistake, you were made a fool of, that you should not have agreed, that you lost a lot of money, you should not have paid out so much, or you should have got much more, you cannot do anything, because it's a settlement. It's an agreed between the parties. Once you have agreed, good, bad, or indifferent, if you are in your full senses, you are capacitated to make that decision, just because it's a bad economic or emotional decision for you, does not mean you can go back and change it. There is a finality to that judgment. In the case of an injunction, it's something that's handed down by court. You can appeal it.
Ma'am, moving on to the next question. This is from Mr. Yogesh Shinde. He wants to ask, can an advocate who is a party to the dispute itself send legal notice to the opposite party? And if yes, then under which provision of law? And also, will such notice given by a proposed litigant who himself is an advocate be considered to have given rise to a cause of action, and whether a civil suit can be filed after sending such notice to the opposite party?
Yes. The only thing is that you have to remember that you cannot file, you cannot send the notice wearing your hat as a lawyer. You have to send it on a plain piece of paper. Any party can send a legal notice to anybody else. They can send a notice. It is not a legal notice, then it's just simply a notice. Right? And you will say that I am so-and-so, So when we send a legal notice, what do we say? We say under instructions from and on behalf of our client so-and-so, resident at so-and-so, we have to state as follows. Then you give the facts, then you say what you want, then you final paragraph, you give the the notice itself, what exactly is the notice, and then you end the notice, right? Here what happens is you will say that I so-and-so, I have this particular issue with you. So I'm sending you this notice on these facts, and this is what I want you to do. Just like as a lawyer, if you want to appear in your own matter, all you have to do is to remove your band. You cannot appear party in person, even if you happen to be a lawyer, you cannot appear as a lawyer. You will be noted in the order sheet also as a petitioner or a defendant. Okay, does that answer your question, Yogesh?
I think perfectly, ma'am. We'll move on to the next question. That is by one of the participants in the CPC course, Colonel Rajesh Tandonji. He wants to ask, firstly, is regular first appeal and regular second appeal against orders, judgments, decree, all of these three?
No. It's only against the judgment and decree. And judgment and decree go hand in hand. Decree is the operative part and the judgment is the reasoning part and where you come to a conclusion. The decree is what is the operative part, what are you supposed to do as a result of that judgment. So if the judge has decided that in favor of, let's say, the plaintiff, then what is the defendant supposed to do? If the plaintiff is supposed to do something also, then the plaintiff's whatever they are supposed to do will also be written there. So all regular first appeal, regular second appeal arises from a judgment and decree. The orders that you get in the interim of a case will be will go as FAOs, first appeal against order.
Got it, ma'am. Ma'am, secondly, he wants to ask, in a lot of judgment, you find that court refers that learned counsel for the plaintiff or learned counsel for the respondent referred to such and such cases, but then it is also said that you do not cite citations in a plaint. I request you to clarify the position on this, whether case laws be referred in plaint or in argument stage.
No, only at the argument stage. Only at the argument stage. Your plaint is your facts. It has got nothing to do with. So you mold your facts according to what the law is. And very often what we do is that if we want to cite a particular judgment at the time of arguments, we look at that judgment. And if there is something which is helpful to us, which we feel that this is applicable to us on all fours. So what do we do? अपना जो लैंग्वेज होता है हम उसको उस जजमेंट के लैंग्वेज के हिसाब से मॉडिफाई करके प्लेंट में लिखते हैं सो दैट जब हम आर्ग्यूमेंट की स्टेज में उसको पॉइंट आउट करते हैं कि सी दिस इज व्हाट आई हैव रिटन यही हम इस जजमेंट से आपको बता रहे हैं कि ये जजमेंट भी यही कह रही है यहाँ पर आकर अटकता है मैं बट आप प्लेंट में जजमेंट्स नहीं साइट कर सकते दैट्स अ नो नो In Got fact, it, you know, I'll just share with you, I've done a lot of work in Germany. And so in Germany, they have a very different system from India. They have no system of oral arguments. What you have to do is you have to prepare your brief. So if you want to go to court, you will prepare your brief stating X, Y, Z, A, B, C, D, why you want a particular relief. And you will state only the facts. Nothing more. And you will state your relief and you will file it before the judge. That copy will be sent to the opposite party. They will also present their facts. No judgments, no nothing at all. Full stop. And then the judge just decides. That's why cases in Germany finish very fast because the judge just reads two sides, decides ki achha theek hai, ye law hai. Koi law nahi hota, koi argument nahi hoti, kuch nahi hota. There's a downside to that also, because sometimes when the when the evidence takes place, when you you know, when you lead the evidence, things come out in evidence to show what is right and what is wrong.
Right. So, like, is it for the judge to know all the law, or is there a team that will see ki kya law hai? So, how does it happen?
It's for the judge to know. So, if a particular matter goes before a judge, he has the facts, he will research the law. Aapko nahi karna hai. Matlab, aap apne liye to research karenge, because accordingly you will make your case. But it's not for you to point the judge in that direction. So, if there is no fight per se, there is no adversarial situation per se. There are two people who will both put their own pleadings before the judge, and the judge will decide.
Great. Moving on to the next question, ma'am. What is the difference between, this comes from Yogesh Shinde, again a participant from the CPC course. What is the difference between reply, written statement, replication, and rejoinder?
Okay. Replication is to an application. Any application, when you reply to it, it's a replication. You can also say reply. A written statement is the response or the reply to a plaint. A rejoinder is a response to the written statement. In a writ petition, it can be the response to a counter affidavit, but basically, rejoinders and plaints or petitions are filed by the plaintiff, the one who institutes the litigation, whether it's the plaintiff or the petitioner, and written statements and counter affidavits are filed by the opposite party.
Right. Ma'am, next question is from Mr. G.S. Chauhan. He wants to ask, respected ma'am, there is a mandatory rule under Order 17 to give 3 adjournments to a party. What is your view on this rule? Really, does it happen in practical life?
We are all aware it doesn't, because you can always have a very good reason. But at least the fact that there are 3 adjournments allowed by law, and thereafter, you know, it's difficult. So what happens is that 3 adjournments are allowed as a matter of right. You can say, I have a personal difficulty, I'm unable to argue it today, I'm unable to do this today. You can get your adjournments, right? But after that, you have to start justifying your adjournments. So it, of course, makes it harder to get adjournments, unless the plaintiff or the defendant doesn't really bother. और वो चले जा रहे हैं, कोर्ट इज ऑल्सो नॉट बॉदर्ड, ठीक है, एडजर्नमेंट हो गई, आगे बढ़ो.
राइट मैम. सो मैम, इज देयर एनी वे दैट यू कैन योरसेल्फ एक्टिवली और पैसिवली इन्फ्लुएंस द नंबर ऑफ एडजर्नमेंट्स दैट आर गिवन टू अ पार्टी?
यस, यू कैन ऑब्जेक्ट. You can say that I want this objection to be recorded in writing in the order sheet. You can file an application stating that there are these number of adjournments have been granted, you are suffering, there should be a shorter date, or there should be whatever XYZ. There are lots of ways to do it.
And they work.
Well, let's say they work better than not doing it at all. Sometimes they work very well, sometimes they don't work so well, but you can't not do something.
Right, correct. Ma'am, so there's a very particular question that I have received about adverse possession. Totally your call if we have to take it or not. The person says that the latest law on adverse possession, that is the judgment on Grewal by Supreme Court, I'm not sure if I know that, it needs an assertion or communication of hostility to be made to the opposite party, the true owner, by the adverse possessor. How can that be done?
Okay. So this is a little problematic, actually, according to me, because the law of adverse possession is really based on abandonment more than anything else. So, for example, if somebody does not look after their property, does not pay their property taxes, does not do anything, and somebody else takes over the property, starts paying the property taxes, gets a bijli meter in their name, does all kinds of things, then there is some assertion of ownership, correct? Now, how do you give notice of that assertion of ownership, correct? One of the ways is, the simplest way I can explain it to you is, when people buy properties on GPAs. If you buy a property on an agreement to sell, and you get a GPA, and you don't go for a sale deed, 12 years after that agreement to sell, you move into the property, you're living there, you're paying all the house tax, the bijli, water, everything, you've got the bijli meter converted, you've got the water meter converted to your name, you're paying the house tax in the name of the original owner, but you're paying the house tax. You may even have got a mutation and started paying the house tax in your name, but that's very difficult. Normally it wouldn't happen. But once 12 years elapse from that agreement to sell, then your title is perfected. Right? Now, in Delhi at least, from 2003, your agreement to sell must be registered. If your agreement to sell is not registered, you cannot come to court and agitate. Because they're trying to close all the loopholes on these power of attorney properties, for example. Similarly, supposing there is some plot. And let's take an example that there is an empty plot and somebody takes possession of that empty plot and starts building and builds a two-storied house there. That is notice of the fact that you are treating it as owner.
Right, ma'am.
If the owner knows about this fact and doesn't object to the fact that you're building, then that itself is, you can take it as adverse possession, or you can take it in the Easements Act and you can claim that you have a right to be there on the property, you can't be evicted. That will depend on the facts and circumstances.
Right. Ma'am, and another follow-up question on the same thing is that if a person's home or shop is destroyed by the true owner, the person was in adverse possession, the true owner came and destroyed the home or shop, is the adverse possessor considered to be dispossessed, or he is still in possession? The person has only destroyed, not taken the possession.
Actually, there is a case, I think it's a Madras judgment or something, Tamil Nadu, but in the days when Chennai was known as Madras. Basically, the judgment is very clear. In that case, there was a person and he was in possession of a certain part of a trust land or something. And he was not a very well-off person. The trust was a very strong entity. And after many, many, many years, they suddenly told him to vacate. And he said, no, this is my home. I cannot vacate. Maybe this was a second generation. I've forgotten the full facts. Cut a long story short. They forcibly threw him out of the premises. And he then went to court. And the Madras High Court held that his dispossession was illegal. And that once your adverse possession is complete, then thereafter, even if you're thrown out of the premises. So the cutoff is very important. 12 years. 12 years is your time for adverse possession. Have you been in possession unobstructed for 12 years? If the person comes after 12 years and he burns down whatever he does, he dispossesses you. Even then, once you can prove that adverse possession had completed, this man had knowledge, and he didn't do anything willfully and knowingly, then you can get the property back.
Right. Ma'am, I have a question here. If suppose adverse possession hai and the person is dispossessed violently through an intrusion. So what is the best remedy to go for? Like hum 6 SRA mein jaye ya 456 CRPC mein jaye ya fir hum isme aa jaye limitation adverse possession.
We have to go in both things. We have to go both in to get repossession, and we have to go in CRPC for criminal trespass.
Achha. Right.
Naturally, because kahin to tukka lagega na.
Okay. Theek hai. So ma'am, next question is from Sonal Modi. It's a follow up on the rejoinder thing. So rejoinder, sorry. So she wants to ask, can we know more terms like sir rejoinder that we need to take care in civil suit?
You know, this was just an example I gave you because I just wanted to take you through the steps of the pleading. But I really think that, Sonal, this is something which I ought to leave to the people who are actually going to be unpackaging the CPC for you, because this is simply an overview of CPC. So it would not be right to, you know, sort of chomp into their turf. And also the problem is that they will explain it in their own sequential manner, in their own fashion. And then, you know, it will just confuse you. So I think that Raghav has already told you all that there is a full-fledged course. There's 7 lawyers and they're all going to take parts of the CPC and explain them to you. I think you should wait for that.
Right, ma'am. And it also struck my mind just now that if you go on Lawyers Club India, aapko ek search ka option dikhega, and there's one forum thread and there's an article also jisme different CPC terms and unki full forms and what is the use in civil cases wo diya hua hai. So if you can look for it, do look for it or get in touch with me or any teammate and we'll share the link with you. So usme kafi, it's a lot to learn there. Ma'am, next question is from Mr. Ravi. He asked, is there a particular format of written submission for filing a particular documentary evidence on record?
There is no such thing as a written submission for filing documentary evidence. In a civil suit, when you draft your plaint is in 2 parts. The first part is what you are pleading, and then you have this a second part of it, which is a list of documents along with documents. So you make a list of all the documents which you think are necessary and relevant, and then you make then you list them one by one, and you number those pages and you file those documents in that particular order. So there are no written submissions that go per se with a document. However, in your plaint, you can refer to the fact that there is a lease deed or there is a legal notice or there is a reply to the notice, etc., etc. But they will go in your document list of documents along with documents.
Right, ma'am. Ma'am, next question is from Mr. Manish Ranjan. He wants to ask, in case the defendant has not filed the WS, can he still go on to cross-examine the plaintiff's witnesses and discredit them and get the suit dismissed in its favor?
Yes, he can. There are 2 parts to a suit. Please understand this. For example, let's say there is a probate of a will. Okay. Now, the defendant doesn't object to the will. It doesn't mean that the will will be probated and grant the right will be granted to you. Even then, you have to bring your witnesses, you have to prove the will, you have to show that if it was registered, the registrar has to be called. All of this has to be done. Now, at that stage, the defendant can join the proceedings at any stage. He may have lost his right of written statement, true, but he can join. And he can discredit your witness, because if he discredits your witness and you are not able to prove the will, then what will happen is that the probate will not be granted. That's the simplest example to give.
Right, ma'am. Ma'am, another question is that what mistakes commonly you have seen in the plaint or written statement which young lawyers make?
Okay. Written statement. The first common mistake, and I see this a lot these days and I'm actually quite appalled by it. The first common mistake is that somehow people get the idea that filing a written statement means you have to deny all the facts that are given in the plaint. It's not so. So we had one matrimonial matter where the opposing counsel filed the written statement in an RCR and he denied the marriage. Just one second, please hold on.
Yeah. What happened? What is the time? Oh, hell. Just tell them to wait and please just do it. I'm dying of heat. I'm just. Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Guys, can you just give me 5 minutes? I seem to have a little bit of an emergency. I'll just be back.
I cannot get it off.
Guys, in the meantime, you can share up your feedback on the first class that we are having in the group or in any of the WhatsApp groups that we have for Lawyers Club India or on any of our pages. And if you have any more questions, keep sending. We'll stop when we have to. Also, you can check out the CPC course until ma'am comes back. I'm sending the link in the chat. Ma'am, you're muted right now. You'll have to unmute. I've sent you the request.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. I'm so sorry.
No problem, ma'am. If there's something that you need to attend to, we
no,
can
no, no, no. No, I have sorted it out. It's just that I was getting some work done because in my house, because well, let's say we are between lockdowns, so
yeah,
that's why.
Right, huh. Ma'am. We were at the mistakes that lawyers make in WS.
Yeah. So what they will do is, I was telling you about this particular case that we had where it was an RCR, matrimonial matter, and the opposite party lawyer just said, contents of para 1 are denied, para 2 are denied, para 3 are... So he actually ended up denying the marriage. He ended up denying the fact that the parties were Hindus. He ended up denying the fact that... I mean, it was completely... So what I'm saying is that when you are responding to a claim, please be very careful that it's not just a blanket denial to everything. You must exercise your mind. And in relation to this, I'm going to tell you something that happened to me. I was a much younger lawyer. And there was a case which was filed by a firm of Calcutta lawyers against my client. Now, this was a property matter, and I'm sure a lot of you are aware, but for those who are not, I'll clarify that property, the territorial jurisdiction, is where the property is situated. So the property was situated in what is now Uttarakhand. And the law, because land is a state subject, so the laws in different states can vary. Now what happened was that the lawyers in Calcutta filed the suit as per the law which was prevalent in West Bengal. And actually, that completely killed the case of their client. So, wonderful, they filed it. Guess what I did? I didn't have the time to read the law because I was handed the papers and told that the date was in 4 days, and it was apparently the last opportunity to file the written statement, because the problem was that these people had been taking time for some 2 years or something. Earlier, there was no limitation on the time you could take to file a written statement. So the court had given them some 2 last opportunities, and the court had said, we'll close your right. So they gave me some 3 days. I had no time to research, no time to look at the law. What I did was I read the plaint and I simply denied. Okay. And I also filed my written statement. After filing the written statement, when I went to the law, I realized that this guy actually made a complete mess of it. So he actually had filed a case that was completely in favor of my client, but I had gone and destroyed it by then denying everything he stated. So I was supporting his case, he was supporting my case. Literally, this is the position. So I was very worried that now he's going to file a rejoinder. He'll accept all my statements and that will be the end of it. He'll get a decree in his favor because it's an admission. He can also file a order 12 rule 6 and say, all right, there's an admission. My case is 100%. Let me get my this thing and walk away. So I was desperate. I was looking at everything and I just didn't know what to do. But then I realized that in the court fee, when you calculated the court fee without rounding it off, he had paid some 3 rupees or some 5 rupees, something like that. 3 rupees and 50 paise less or something. So I raised an objection to the court fee on the next day to hearing. And the court was very irritated with me. And they said, what do you... I filed a proper application. I said that the court fee, this case needs to be dismissed because for want of adequate court fee. So the judge said, how much court fee? He's put all the court fee. I said, no, it's less by whatever, 3 rupees 50 paisa, whatever it is. So the judge was very irritated. He said, that's a minor calculation mistake and we are within our rights to allow it. It's okay. So I said, Your Honor can allow the application. I don't mind. And say that he needs to file an amended claim. So the court was even more irritated. They said, you actually want him to file an amended claim. We can just pass an order that he will pay 3 rupees 50 paisa, whatever. I said, no, he needs to file an amended claim because the plaint as it stands is not correct. The court fee is not sufficient. So the judge was highly irritated, but he passed an order saying, all right, file an amended claim. And he fined me, I think, 2,000 rupees, which is a lot of money in those days. But I almost danced out of the court. I was so happy. So when the written statement, when the plaint was refiled with the amended court fee, I told the court, I said, if he amends his written statement, his plaint, even by one sentence, I have the right to file a fresh written statement. So I want to file a fresh written statement. And the court was very, very, very annoyed with me. But he granted me permission to file a fresh written statement because that's the law, that if the plaint is amended, then you have a right to file a fresh written statement. I filed a fresh written statement and I said, I agree with para so-and-so, I agree with para so-and-so, I agree with para so-and-so. It's all accepted, 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 accepted. So by the end of it, when I filed it, the plaintiff's counsel just leapt up in his chair. He says, what is going on? And the judge started laughing. He says, now I understand why you wanted to file an amended plaint. And he told the opposing counsel that I'm really sorry, but she is agreeing. I have to pass a decree and you have asked for this decree. Now you have to bear the consequences of this decree. So that was one case where the denial got me into a lot of trouble because I didn't apply my mind at all.
That is so very interesting, ma'am. Things that we only learn in the court. Nothing else that can teach us that. So can we move on to the next question or there's anything
Absolutely.
That we want to add?
No.
Acha. Okay. So ma'am, next question is from Mr. Vikramjeet Singh. Are the preliminary objections taken by the defendant decided in the court immediately after the completion of the pleadings or are they decided later on? And if yes, when they are decided?
If the preliminary objections are taken, mostly they are decided. First of all, you have to ensure that your preliminary objection finds its way into becoming an issue. If it does not become an issue, it will never be decided. Okay? This I explained to you earlier also, that framing of issues is very, very important. And you must frame your issues in such a way that you take into account all the different parameters, including the preliminary objection. Ab agar aap ye jo preliminary objections hain, inko aapne issue mein bana liya, theek hai? Then you are in a position to tell the court ki dekhiye, agar ye preliminary objection decide ho jati hai mere favor mein, then this suit will not lie. But evidence needs to be led. So since it is so germane to the whole suit, since it is the crux of the whole suit, aap is preliminary objection ko pehle le lijiye so that you cut short the litigation. You are within your rights to say it and the court may or may not agree with you, but you can ask for that. If that doesn't happen, then normally the preliminary objection which is made into an issue will be decided with the rest of the issues right at the end.
Right, ma'am. I'm moving on to the next question by Charu Divya. She wants to ask, if divorce is filed by one side, one party comes every time on date and other party almost never shows up and sends an application every now and then, how long can it be entertained and what a lawyer can actively do to tackle the situation?
Okay. Cases which are not prosecuted properly, if the non-prosecution or the poor prosecution is on the behalf of the plaintiff or the petitioner, can be dismissed for non-prosecution. And if the defendant does not appear, then the case, his right to or her right to various aspects of the case, for example, the right to file written statement, can be closed. Similarly, the right to cross-examination of the plaintiff's witnesses can be closed. The right to file evidence can be closed. If a written statement file nahi kari hai, you can't find you cannot file independent evidence. What you can file, however, even if you've not filed a written statement, is to file evidence which will discredit the evidence which is filed by the plaintiff. That you can do. So it's a very limited scope. You cannot lead evidence of your own, but you can file evidence which is contingent on the plaintiff's evidence. So wo bhi aapka right close. Even your right of final argument can be closed if you don't do the final arguments when you're supposed to do them and the court runs out of indulgence to give you.
Right, ma'am. Then the next question is from Vikramjeet Singh again. He wants to ask, a follow-up hai usi pe ki whether we should be doing the evidence in pleadings and all that. So it is stated in the law books that we should not be stating the evidence in pleading, but we do have to put in annexures with our plaint. Can you please explain the position?
No, we do not have to put annexures with the plaint. I explained this to you. You have to give a list of documents along with documents. That's number one. Number two, you must remember that evidence is oral and it is written, which means documentary. Now, if your documentary evidence has to go in along with your plaint, of course it does. But your written, the evidence which your witnesses will come and give, your oral evidence, you don't have to disclose it in the plaint. You can frame the plaint in such a way that it encompasses what your witness is going to say. How you are going to prove it, by means of which oral testimony, through which witness, you don't have to explain in the plaint.
Right, I'm taking up the next question in just a minute. I have a little technical glitch. Everything seems to be hung up. Yeah. So, ma'am, next one is again on the same issue. I believe in criminal matters, one can cite the case citations in the complaint or appeal, etc. Against civil matters where we cannot. Can you please clarify?
Sorry, come again.
Ma'am, civil cases, mein, jaise aapne bataya ki, we don't have to cite the case laws in the plaint. Is that, on the other hand, in criminal cases, allowed?
Okay. So criminal cases, please understand one thing. Mostly criminal cases, there is no plaint. So you will file a complaint, it will go to the police station, the police will investigate it, they will turn it into an FIR, and then that FIR will come to court, then they will do some more investigation, and then they will find the final report, which could be a closure report, it could be a charge sheet, either one of the two. Once a charge sheet is filed, then your arguments will be heard on charges, and thereafter, the trial will commence. So where is the question of filing a written statement? You don't.
Right, ma'am. And ma'am, in appeals?
In appeal, actually, you are not allowed to file a reply. it's a very special consideration which is given to you. It's not a matter of right. So even in a civil case, when you file an appeal, it's supposed to be actually heard and decided on the basis of the documents in the appeal itself, because it is supposed to be, along with the trial court record, a complete compendium of the entire case. So when you file the appeal, there ought not to be a long drawn out procedure. You ought to file your appeal. It should come up for final hearing and you argue the matter, you show your evidence with the trial court record, and you explain to the judge why the trial court judge went wrong, in which direction he went wrong, and why you feel that in your appeal it should be allowed and you should be granted the relief and the trial court judgment should be set aside, and that's the end of it. So in appeals, actually, reply from the opposite party is not a matter of right. You sometimes, when an appeal is filed, there may be a situation where something, the way it's been said, the way it's been crafted, may not be exactly how it is. It may also have allowed certain facts to creep in which were not there at the stage of the trial court. So therefore, you can ask the court that, look, there's all this material, I need to reply to it. Please give me the right to reply to this appeal. And then you can hear both sides with both the reply and the appeal in place.
Right, ma'am. Ma'am, another question by Mr. Yogesh Shinde. He wants to ask, are there any basic provisions in any statute which can be referred before drafting a legal notice?
You know, I'm honestly not aware. I have no idea. But please remember that when you draft your legal notice, why are you drafting it? You're drafting it because you have a legal right and you are therefore asking the opposite party to do something or not do something. Once you send that legal notice, it's the base of your case that you're going to file in the future. So clearly, whatever law applies to you, whatever your rights are, whatever your thing is, the legal notice that you send to an opposite party becomes, in a sense, a small, it's the base, it's actually, your plaint will go pretty much according to your legal notice. If your plaint deviates from your legal notice, then you can consider that you have trouble.
Right, ma'am. Ma'am, next question, how to authorize a recognized agent under Order 3, Rule 1 or 2?
Again, I think this is a question you should wait for your CPC masterclass to answer. Whoever is going to do the orders will definitely not only answer this question, but they'll probably explain this to you. So, you know, if we just take bits and pieces out of it, I'm doing pleadings because, yes, pleadings are something which is a wide scope and different people have different insights in pleadings. But interpretation, I'm steering a little clear of in this class.
Right, ma'am. Makes sense. So, ma'am, a next question is a peculiar one in which a wife filed a suit for maintenance for child but later withdrew the suit. Can a wife at later stage file a suit for maintenance in the interest of the child?
Yes. Yes.
Right. And ma'am, Supreme Court has recently discarded the credit of WhatsApp in terms of evidentiary value. What if the suit is filed on the basis of WhatsApp chat to cover limitation period?
First of all, limitation in terms of maintenance. Let's be clear. It's the responsibility of the husband to support the child till the child is 18 at least. And courts have held that, you know, till a child starts working, till a girl gets married. So where is the question of limitation coming? Are you trying to say that you wait for 18 years and then pilot suit and say mujhe 18 saal ka maintenance nahi diya. Maintenance suits are normally maintenance is calculated from the day you file the suit. So back maintenance aapko nahi milega. Unless you can show that you know you withdrew the maintenance suit because he made certain promises to you, he did certain XYZ, whatever it may be. Right? That's number one. Number two, I'm not sure that this is a correct interpretation that WhatsApp evidence has been struck down by the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court has said that WhatsApp evidence has to be backed up by a 65B certificate. There has to be, you have to, you know, tell the court that you have the original device, etc. If you have all those things, then WhatsApp evidence, we are using it every day.
Right, ma'am. Shadab, if you have a follow-up question or if you can clarify more on that question, I can maybe unmute you and then you can ask directly. And we'll move on to the next one until then. Ma'am, there's another question that a person wants to ask. He says that if an employer is not paying salary by 50% and claims that government had allowed employers to cut salary by 50% in the COVID period last year, how much is that law point supported by law?
Well, I think the employer would definitely have the advantage and the benefit because the government did say that, you know, in the this thing of keeping businesses going, they wanted to ensure that, you know, businesses didn't fold, and they said that, you know, salary cuts can be given. So, yes, there is that provision. But however, it depends on you. How creative can you be in actually making the facts of your case? So if you can actually prove that the revenue stream did not dry up and they're just making use of a COVID provision not to pay the salary, and that is undue enrichment, then you can actually have a good case to stand on.
Right, ma'am. Ma'am, okay, we are very close to 8. Actually, it's already 8. So, ma'am, whenever we have to stop, we can stop. We have 4 or 5 more questions to take.
No problem. We can take it.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Ma'am, next question is, can you throw a little light on how to draft in legal language and how can young students improve on using legal language while drafting? Young students face this problem a lot. Is it important to draft by using legal language or the status is different?
If I were you, I wouldn't worry so much about legal language. What I would worry about is using accurate English and or vernacular, whatever you're drafting. But please understand that language is very nuanced. So whatever language you're drafting in, try and become proficient in that language so that jo aapko kehna hai, aap keh sakein. Not ki aapko kehna kuch hai aur actually aapki language ki kami ki wajah se aap kuch aur hi keh rahe hain. Ideally speaking, legal language, koi bahut bade Latin words use karne ki zarurat nahi hai, koi bahut zyada high flying words use karne ki zarurat nahi hai. Simple English bhi chalegi, simple vernacular bhi chalega. But jo aap kehna chahte hain, sometimes kya hota hai ki I notice that lawyers kehna kuch chahte hain. Wo argue jab karte hain apne case ko to bol kuch aur rahe hote hain, par jo pleadings mein likha hota hai wo bilkul hi kuch aur hota hai, matlab uska meaning kuch aur nikalta hai. And I can see clearly ki this is only because unka language mein haath tang hai. And when I say language mein haath tang hai, I don't mean ki English mein haath tang hai, I mean sometimes Hindi mein bhi haath tang hota hai, because wo utna dimag hi nahi lagate hain ki mujhe kya kehna hai. Matlab the question is ki jo aap kehna cha rahe hain wo bilkul ekdam to the point us reading mein aana chahiye. That is important. Aur agar aapne ye achieve kar liya, तो समझ लीजिए कि आपकी प्लेंट तो दौड़ेगी, लेकिन अगर आपने उसको और इम्प्रूव करना है देन द नेक्स्ट थिंग दैट यू नीड टू लुक एट इज कि आप फॉर्मल लैंग्वेज यूज करते हैं, कोर्ट में आप इनफॉर्मल लैंग्वेज नहीं यूज करते हैं। सो कोशिश करके जो भी लैंग्वेज है अपनी उसको फॉर्मल रखिए। कलोकियल हिंदी नहीं चलेगी, कलोकियल इंग्लिश नहीं चलेगी, उसमें फॉर्मल लैंग्वेज यूज होगी। और अगर आपने वो स्टेज भी पार कर लिया है तब आप ये स्टेज यूज कर, तब स्टेज पे पहुंच गए हैं दैट यू कैन लुक एट लीगल मैक्सिम्स। आपको नेट पे तो आजकल मतलब इट्स लाइक अ फ्री फॉर ऑल, आप जितना ढूंढेंगे उतना आपको मिलेगा। तो आप लीगल मैक्सिम्स अगर देखेंगे और आप उनको समझेंगे, आप उनको पार्ट ऑफ वोकैबुलरी बना लेंगे तो आप वो भी यूज कर सकते हैं। बट सबसे पहले तो अपनी लैंग्वेज को क्लीन करिए, लीगल लैंग्वेज तो बहुत दूर की बात है।
राइट मैम। एंड मैम इफ आई मे इंटरजेक्ट हियर, लाइक इट्स जस्ट माय ऑब्जर्वेशन, आई थिंक आई एम यंगर टू मोस्ट ऑफ यू एंड वेरी इनएक्सपीरियंस्ड टू एनीवे एडवाइस, बट अभी तक जितना मैंने सीखा है अबाउट यूजिंग द लैंग्वेज, आई थिंक आई हैव गॉट इट फ्रॉम रीडिंग जजमेंट। तो उसमें व्हाट जज, हाउ जजेस यूज द लैंग्वेज, उससे बहुत हेल्प मिलती है। एंड बाकी तो आई थिंक इट्स अबाउट रीडिंग अगेन एंड अगेन, गेटिंग फैमिलियर विद द फैक्ट्स। And I'm moving on to the,
I just want to make an observation here. You're absolutely right. And that's why, you know, in our internship program, hum log kya karte hain ki hum log, we try and read certain judgments, you know, landmark judgments jaisi hoti hai. To hum unko interns ke saath, juniors ke saath padhne ki koshish karte hain. Why? Because sometimes, these judgments are so nuanced that jo young lawyers hote hain wo ek baar padhte hain, do baar padhte hain, teen baar bhi padhte hain, koshish bhi karte hain, wo clarity nahi aati unko thought. To agar usi judgment ko hum hamare sath padhte hain and then we, you know, stop and I explain and then we go on wherever they are stuck, we clarify the judgment, then it becomes then, and also you learn how to read a judgment, how to unpackage a judgment. Sometimes you don't have time, it's a 500 page judgment. Ab aap overnight ek kuch draft kar rahe hain. Remember jab humne ye Pragati Maidan Hall of Nations ka case, to hamari jo writ petition thi wo jis din dismiss hui uske agle din hum court mein khade the with our appeal, our LPA. तो ओवरनाइट वी जस्ट 8 बजे शाम को हमको ऑर्डर मिला था, तो सुबह 10 बजे आई वॉज रेडी टू, 10:30 बजे दिल्ली हाईकोर्ट खुलता है, 10:30 बजे आई वॉज वेटिंग टू मैंशन द मैटर कि हमको अर्जेंटली उसको लिस्ट करिए और आज ही सुनिए, एंड वी गॉट द अर्जेंट लिस्टिंग, वी डिड द फाइलिंग। तो जब ऐसे ओवरनाइट होता है, 500 पेज की जजमेंट है, आप उसको 500 पेज को पढ़ना चाहें भी तो आप नहीं पढ़ सकते हैं। तो कैसे पढ़ना है जजमेंट को, स्पीड रीड कैसे करना है, कहाँ देखोगे, क्या सुधे, क्या उठाओगे, क्या नहीं उठाओगे, सो दैट यू गेट द जिस्ट ऑफ द जजमेंट, दैट इज ऑल्सो एन आर्ट, इट्स वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट। आपके पास 200 जजमेंट है अगर एक ही मैटर के ऊपर, समटाइम्स इट हैपेंस, यू नो पीपल, आई रिमेम्बर जस्टिस दलवीर भंडारी, ही गेव अ जजमेंट, इट वॉज अ कंपेंडियम, ही कोटेड सो मेनी जजमेंट्स। अब अगर आपको वो जजमेंट लीजरली पढ़नी है तो ठीक है, आप पढ़ सकते हैं, बट अगर आपके पास नहीं है उतना टाइम, आप उस जजमेंट को यूज करना चाह रहे हैं, हाउ विल यू डू इट, दैट्स आल्सो एन आर्ट।
करेक्ट मैम। सो मैम कैन वी मूव ऑन टू द नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन?
एब्सोल्युटली
राइट। एंड आई थिंक दिस विल बी आवर लास्ट क्वेश्चन, वी विल नॉट टेक मोर क्वेश्चंस आगे। And if there are any more questions, आप lawyersclubindia@gmail.com पे भेज सकते हैं, and we'll try to get them answered. This is from Sunil Verma, ma'am. He wants to ask, what happens when the plaint is based upon a misstatement, a lie, which is a lie? Is it liable to be summarily dismissed by the court under Order 7, Rule 11? To be more precise, can evidence be led by the defendant to expose such misstatement?
Yes. But not under Order 7, Rule 11. You will lead that evidence under Section 44 of the Evidence Act. But you cannot lead it at the initial stage, because what does Section 44 says? The Section 44 says that if any person gets any benefit on the basis of a lie or a fraud, then that judgment, decree or order has to be set aside. So agar, supposing everybody has a right to come to court, okay, they have to prove their case, you as a defendant have to disprove that case. So अगर वो झूठ बोलकर आए हैं या तो वो आप डिसप्रूव कर लोगे, और अगर आप अपना प्रूव कर सकते हो तो आप अपने एविडेंस में उसको लेकर आओगे, बट केस तो आपको झेलना पड़ेगा।
Got it, ma'am. Ma'am, एक क्वेश्चन और आ गया, तो दिस विल बी आवर लास्ट क्वेश्चन, एंड मे बी शादाब जी वुड वांट टू टॉक टू यू फॉर अ मिनट और सो, एंड वी विल क्लोज द सेशन देन एंड देयर।
नो प्रॉब्लम।
दिस क्वेश्चन इज दैट सपोज आई हैव अ डिस्प्यूट with a university, but the university did not provide me any remedy. Then I go into appeals and file against the university to the regulatory commission, then to higher education ministry or other institutions like IOG, Human Rights Commission, UGC, etc. And they all work in sort of collusion, and they do not provide any lawful remedy. So will the
Sorry, your voice cracked up. Will what? Will the cause of action be one? Hello?
Can you hear me, ma'am?
Hello. Now I can, yeah.
Acha, I think there was some glitch. I'll repeat the question, ma'am. So the person says, suppose I have a dispute with a university, but the university did not provide me any remedy. So, can I file a suit against the university?
No, one second. Now, see, this is what I mean by clarity. Many people can have disputes with the university. It can be a lawyer, it can be a student, it can be a professor, it can be a service provider, it can be a safai karamchari, it can be a lecturer, it can be a person who's aspiring to be a lecturer, so who's applied for a post in the university. Now, when you say that, supposing I have a dispute with the university, who's this person who's having the dispute? Because the forum will differ depending on where you are located.
Right, ma'am. So, abhi isme kya hai ki, let's suppose that he's a student because he wants to go on to a different question with this. So, what he says is that I have filed a suit against the university, and the university has not given any resolution. Then I complained to the...
One moment. Has he filed a suit in a court of law?
Yes, ma'am.
What suit has he filed?
Now, that's not clear. But what he wants to ask is that he has gone to other institutions going against the decision of the university. And he wants to ask, if I have... will the cause of action be one or separate when I go to different... institutions and get rejected?
Okay.
He has filed a complaint.
First of all, let me explain something to you. If he's already filed a suit, you can go to 25 people to get a remedy. But the matter is sub judice, they cannot do anything for him. So all these 25 people he's talking about, whether he goes to UGC or he goes to the ministry or he goes here, he goes there, he goes everywhere. All of these things have to happen before he files a suit. Right? That's the first thing. Secondly, if he's filed a suit, then that suit will proceed. Now, when you file a suit, it means you have a substantive right, which is under some law. You may be quoting the university regulations, whatever you're doing. You've got some right. You've come under some substantive law. You filed a suit. You have a remedy. The court will decide, following the procedure that we've already outlined. Now, what I think is happening over here is that I don't think he's filed a suit. Can you please ask him?
He says that I have filed a complaint with the university.
Exactly. That is not a suit. So there is a confusion here. Please don't confuse the two things. Filing a complaint in a university and filing a suit are two completely different things. Filing a suit means you have approached a judicial institution like a court or a tribunal. But here he has filed a complaint with the university. Clearly, this is something which does not have some sort of substantive law on which he can stand. So what will happen is we'll take this up. This question we will deal with in the next session, because this actually is a question where you will go in a writ.
Jee,
you will not go in a suit. And this is a right. good example. Flag this question and then we'll take it up. But this question is also interesting and important for another reason. You see, this question was phrased in a way that was not clear. So if I were phrasing that question, I would have said, as a student, I had a complaint against the university relating to X, Y, or Z. And no action was taken on that complaint, or unsatisfactory action was taken. So I went to A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, whatever it was. But they also have not replied satisfactorily. So what is my remedy? What can I do? And will all of these people have to be sued separately or together?
Right, ma'am.
Yeah?
Yes. So, ma'am, lastly, I'm just giving mic to Mr. Shadab. He wants to have a little chat and then we'll close.
Absolutely.
Shadab, do you have the mic?
Okay. Hello, good evening.
Good evening.
Ma'am, very good evening to you and everyone. I've asked you two questions. One is respect to maintenance, and the other one's for respect to the Evidence Act, which was pertaining to the WhatsApp chat. Raghav actually mixed both the questions. Actually, it was meant to be two different set of questions.
I see.
Okay. The first point here being is, recently, in this week itself, on Wednesday, the Supreme Court, headed by the Chief Justice, has passed an order whereby it's mentioned that the WhatsApp chat doesn't have an evidential value. Here it says anything can be created and deleted on social media these days. We don't attach any value to the WhatsApp messages, Supreme Court. Okay, so my question here is, my dilemma here is, I filed a suit which was barred by limitation. Mm-hmm. To get the suit within limitation, I instructed my client to have a WhatsApp communication identifying the parties and taking a consent that the money was loaned to her, and either she accepted or refused it, whatever it is. So the other party accepted the money was received, but she deferred the nature in which the money was received. Based on that evidence, WhatsApp chat, I'll annex that as an annexure and file my suit. In the registry, the suit got cleared by way of the limitation was covered because he has sent a WhatsApp chat very recently. So the suit, actually he loaned it in 2013, 2016, limitation got expired. We filed in 2021. The biggest question here is, with this recent judgment coming up where it says WhatsApp messages doesn't have an evidential value, whether a suit filed based on a WhatsApp chat, though there will be a 65B certificate or not, that's a different story altogether, whether a suit will be maintainable or not.
Okay. Let me answer it like this. Have you read the judgment?
I haven't. I have just read the newspaper cutting.
Yeah,
I've been
please.
Trying to go under.
No. Please. No,
I'm
please
just coming to the front.
Do not go on the basis of that.
Yes, I know. Because
you have to read the judgment because I do not think that the Supreme Court can be so cavalier ki ek 65B ka provision hai, IT Act mein amendment hai, electronic evidence allow ho gaya hai. दुनिया जहान का इलेक्ट्रॉनिक एविडेंस फाइल हो रहा है अभी सुप्रीम कोर्ट में उससे पहले जजमेंट आई थी जहां पर उन्होंने क्लैरिटी दी थी कि अगर आप 65B फाइल कर देते हो तो आपको ओरिजिनल डिवाइस अगर आप कोर्ट में नहीं भी ला सकते हो दैट एविडेंस विल बी एक्सेप्टेड दैट वाज इन द केस ऑफ अ गवर्नमेंट ऑफिसर हु हैड जनरेटेड दैट मटेरियल ऑन हिज ऑफिस कंप्यूटर व्हिच वाज इन द पावर एंड पोजेशन ऑफ द गवर्नमेंट तो द कोर्ट सेड कि अगर 65 बी लग जाता है इवन इफ द पर्सन कैन नॉट से दैट ही कैन ब्रिंग द पर्टिकुलर डिवाइस टू कोर्ट क्लियरली बिकॉज इट बिलोंग्स टू समवन एल्स इट बिलोंग्स टू हिज एम्प्लॉयर द गवर्नमेंट देयरफॉर ही इज नॉट इन अ पोजीशन टू प्रोड्यूस इट इन कोर्ट बट इफ ही गिव्स अ 65 बी इफ दैट डिवाइस एग्जिस्ट देन इतना कुछ होने के बाद एकदम से सुप्रीम कोर्ट मतलब 360 डिग्री टर्न करके बोले कि इलेक्ट्रॉनिक एविडेंस पे हम कोई वो नहीं देते हैं तवज्जो नहीं देते हैं तो बहुत मुश्किल का काम
नहीं एक्चुअली
आई थिंक कि उसमें कुछ कोई एक्सेप्शन में बात करी होगी या उसमें कुछ पर्टिकुलराइज बात करी होगी कि अगर इस टाइप से नहीं होगा तो एविडेंस नहीं लिया जाएगा और समथिंग लाइक दैट
द रीजन दैट हैज पिनपॉइंट मी इज बिकॉज आई हैव वेंट टू द सुप्रीम कोर्ट वेबसाइट आई हैव जस्ट चेक द ऑर्डर्स फॉर द डे ऑन दैट पर्टिकुलर डेट आई कैन सी द कॉज टाइटल आई कैन सी द मैटर बट आई कैन नॉट सी द ऑर्डर सो द थिंग इज आई ऑल्सो अंडरस्टैंड बिकॉज आई हैव बीन फ्रॉम अ जर्नलिज्म बैकग्राउंड And there was one very common judgment which was floating everywhere with a wrong headline that that nominee in a cooperative society is the owner of the flat, which was very wrong, basically. So I understand how the headlines are pasted and basically what are the contents. The reason I was not able to get my hands on the order, so I've just read this cutting. So I thought I just can share it with you so that. Because this is directly affecting my matter also.
Hello.
I think there's some glitch. Ma'am has been disconnected. Sharad ji, but I'll share your
okay.
The snippet that you have sent, I'll share it with ma'am, and we'll see that it is addressed. We'll wait for ma'am to rejoin.
Yes.
Okay, I think ma'am ki maybe the battery is dead or something, but I think we are at the end of the our session today. So I hope everyone has liked what we have done today here, and I think this was a. Just give me a second again.